comes from the Hubler Automotive Group, drivehubler.com studio. That's easy now to remember.
Very cool. Indiana's giant.
It is. It's very cool. It is a rain-soaked and dreary-looking Thursday is today, right?
Yes, very yucky. A lot of low visibility on the highways. Do my best traffic impersonation there, but it was a little rough getting in because of all the continuous rain and all the general traffic you're dealing with going to work. Very gloomy day around the city.
And there is plenty to talk about today. As a matter of fact, in the last hour or so, and look, we do a local sports talk radio show, and that's what we're going to do because we have a lot to talk about between the Pacers and, you know, interesting news with Purdue. I mean, you've got Mason Gillis now in the, you know, Ethan Morton, both in the transfer portal. Mason Gillis is probably the bigger surprise of the two, the Big Ten Sixth Man of the Year. But things do change in terms of just minute distribution now with Zach Edey gone next year for the Boilers. Bob Kravitz will talk about that, amongst other things, with us today. Coming up at 1 o'clock today, Tony East going to join us at 12:30. And then about 30 minutes from now, we're going to go down to Lexington. Not literally, but figuratively.
Going to Keeneland?
What's that?
We're going to Keeneland? That's right. Race some horses?
That's right. We're going to get warmed up for the Derby, right?
All right. Bluegrass Stakes. Let's go.
The There's a guy named Dick Gabriel that, over the course of the years, you know, you do, as you guys know, listeners, and Jimmy, as you know, I mean, when you do what we do for a living, you have regular radio guests on, right, from different markets. Dave Revson's a good example. He's been on this show a handful of times. And Dick Gabriel is a guy that, back when Indiana and Kentucky were annually playing in college basketball, he would have me on to discuss the Indiana side of things, and then I'd have him on for different things. And we've just kind of become buddies through that. Never met the man. But like twice a year, probably we do. And then that led to just, you know, kind of texting back and forth on stuff. So why are you looking at me sheepishly?
Because now my vision is blocked. So I have to adjust. I have to adjust.
The big signs here for the HublerAutomotiveGroup.com does kind of.
I'm just trying to adjust.
You have to change the microphone a little bit. So Dick Gabriel, right when COVID, when things started kind of opening up.
Sure.
I had reached out to him and I said, hey, I've always wanted to go to see where Secretariat, you know, Claiborne Farms, where Secretariat was sired and Secretariat is now his resting place. And Dick Gabriel said, well, I'll meet you over there. It's great. It's right outside of Lexington. Da, da, da. So we met up for a day and spent the day at Claiborne Farms together and went over to Lexington and got lunch and hung out and and first time I'd ever met him in person, but I feel like I've known him for, you know, 25, 30 years. Anyway, he is all over the Kentucky beat. He does Sports Talk Radio in Lexington. He's on the University of Kentucky Football Radio Network. So he's going to join us in about 25 minutes because the Kentucky coaching search is fascinating, number one. I do think it has interest to people here, partially because how does that impact, say, the Indiana-Kentucky series? And Kentucky has always been such a blue blood in college basketball and in the forefront in a lot of areas and kind of a trendsetter in a lot of ways in college basketball. And you have to wonder if they're not a trendsetter again, just in terms of this isn't necessarily a new concept or a novel concept, but the challenges that come with replacing a legendary coach. Because a lot of coaches are like, I'm okay taking that job, but I don't want to be the one immediately following. Go get yourself a Billy Gillespie for 2 years and then I'll come in, right? We'll talk to him about that. But the big news from a national standpoint, and it is obviously impossible for me, for you, Jimmy, for anyone else to at this point probably make any comment or observation that has not already been made about the passing of O.J. Simpson. And the only thing I can say is this. For those that are listening that were either living under a rock in the mid-90s or, more likely, were too young to truly grasp the O.J. Simpson trial, you know, we can sit here until the cows come home talking about whether or not he was innocent, whether he was guilty, whether he was guilty but simply not proven guilty. I mean, there are a million ways that you can have that discussion, and they've all been had. I mean, it's been 30 years. Those discussions have all been had. And Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Goldman, their life was taken from them. The presumption amongst many people is that O.J. Simpson was the one that was responsible for that. He was, by a court of law, found to be not guilty. But the thing that makes the O.J. Simpson storyline and his passing today so noteworthy, so newsworthy, if you will, is the fact that, and this is what I think is really hard, it's almost impossible to overstate this. From 1984, I'll just throw out a number, to 1994, O.J. Simpson was the most ubiquitous former athlete in the American landscape. He was in commercials. He was in movies. He made cameos on television shows. He was in the broadcast booth of major sporting events and football games. He was a commentator. He was handsome. He was gregarious. He was charming. He had a beautiful wife. He had beautiful children. He was a Heisman Trophy winner. He was the poster child of a guy whose career you felt bad for because he played on bad teams. It's all across the board. He was a universally beloved figure. Beloved figure. And to put it in, and I've said this before, and I think people take it offensively because they think that I'm comparing the character of what we later came to know of O.J. Simpson, even regardless of the polarization of his trial, just his behavior, his conduct, his arrogance throughout and since then, you know, he was exposed as a pretty, at the very least, narcissistic, self-centered guy. But I'm just speaking in terms of his universal acceptance amongst the American fan base of sport. The closest that I can think of when thinking about somebody who, after their playing career, is the forefront of American culture, for even for people who were too young to see them play, in terms of the mass media markets and the various ways in which you can see them, quite frankly, is Peyton Manning. Peyton Manning's popularity and just universal, you know, people love Peyton Manning. Even people that are fans of the New England Patriots are like, yeah, I mean, I love the Manning cast. I love when he and Eli do commercials. I love when he's on Saturday Night Live. I love when he makes an appearance here or there. I mean, you could make the argument that Peyton Manning is as well known in the United States today as he was in 2005 when he was quarterbacking the Indianapolis Colts. Charles Barkley and Shaq would be the other two that come to mind because of TNT and the commercials and March Madness commercials and, in Shaq's case, the movies and rap and all that, right? He is literally a multifaceted celebrity. And that's what O.J. Simpson was. The other thing about O.J. Simpson that I think people lose sight of, but it's an important thing to remember, not to necessarily dwell on and try to go back to, but to still remember. And that is, many people don't mention this. O.J. Simpson, and I mean this largely, and I know this is maybe going to offend people. I'm not trying to. O.J. Simpson was a reminder, or maybe not even a reminder, but a first wake-up call for a lot of people in the mid-90s that black and white America were still not as unified as we thought it was. A lot of the majority wanted to say everything's hunky-dory, but a lot of the minority was saying, no, we still feel there is a disparity and a discrepancy amongst the way that we are handled, treated, and the way that we live in this country. And it was easy for the majority to just silent, you know, kind of block that out. But the OJ trial and the reactions to it and the empathy towards it was the reminder for one side of things that we still had an imbalance and a wake-up call to the others that that imbalance existed to some people. And it was a challenging epiphany for our society to go through. And if there's one positive, I guess, that could have come of all of it, and it's hard to say there'd be a positive out of the atrocities of what took place, but if there's one positive that came out of it, it was that it illuminated to a lot of people that we were a country that still had a ton more healing to do off of civil rights in the eras prior to that, and that everything was not just immediately band-aided. But any time that he is going to be in the news, which now will be clearly fewer and further between, But anytime that O.J. Simpson's in the news, those scars, those scabs, and those sensitivities are going to be reawakened. And people are going to, again, immediately discuss about O.J. Simpson the 50,000 variables about it. There's a ton of you know, pretty good one-liners about it and everything today because he became, to a lot of people, a running joke. And but even those running jokes sometimes, although I do think over the course of time, he might have actually bridged us together more so than other events, ironically enough, over the course of the last 30 years. Because it just showed people, it was a hard look in the mirror for society. But nonetheless, passing away at the age of, what was he, 76? That's the other thing. I would have guessed him to be older than that, to be honest with you. 76 years old,
yep.
Is that right?
Yep, 76. And, I mean, for those that I think of my generation and maybe younger, a lot of it, because we did not grow up during the trial of O.J. Simpson, a lot of reawakening and, you know, explaining what that time was like was done with, and I've always talked about the 30 for 30s documentaries. I very much enjoyed those. They're informative if you're a sports fan. Whether you're reliving things or learning about it for the first time, they're incredibly insightful. And there was a long 30 for 30, I think, six-part miniseries, Jake, that came out, 8 years ago this summer, that was O.J. Made in America. It talks about everything. It talks about his upbringing. It talks about the impact that he made at USC with the Buffalo Bills, everything you highlighted, him being, couldn't turn on a TV, kind of like with Shaq or with Charles Barkley today. You can't turn on a TV and not see them doing endorsements. That was O.J. at the time. And then the trial and the fallout from that, all of it is well encapsulated within O.J. Made in America. And then from just an individual performance, if you're into more dramatizations on it, The People versus O.J. Simpson, which came out around that time. Sarah Paulson, Sterling K. Brown, Courtney Vance, lead roles in that on FX. That was also very, very, you know, in terms of actor portrayal, incredibly good. So there's a lot of material out there in terms of just whether it's refreshers or understanding what the time was like. One of the most polarizing, you know, events in American history in terms of, especially when sports collide in there.
The other thing the Simpson trial gave us is, I've mentioned this before, but I've always found this to be incredibly ironic. And we will move on and talk about sports here in 2 minutes, I promise. But I've always found this fascinating, Jimmy. When O.J. Simpson was getting ready, basically probably he and Al Cowlings were getting gas in the Bronco, the night of the Bronco chase, and the LAPD did not know where O.J. Simpson was. His attorney, Robert Kardashian, Bob Shapiro.
Both were.
Yes. Well, yeah, but Kardashian was his friend more than his attorney.
Right.
But Bob Shapiro got up there and said, hey, you know, O.J. wrote a letter that we found, and we want to read this, and we're going to have his dear friend, Robert Kardashian, who was kind of assisting F. Lee Bailey and Shapiro and Johnny Cochran, he's going to read the letter. And the letter was O.J. Simpson pleading for the media to leave his family and children alone, basically saying that this horrible event and everything that's going on, please leave my kids out of it. And the guy that read the letter was this unknown, nobody knew who he was at that time, this unknown attorney that had become buddies with O.J. Simpson named Robert Kardashian. And so Robert Kardashian, during the time that he was reading a letter that O.J. Simpson had written about protecting his kids' identities and lives, basically, and O.J. Simpson wrote that letter at Robert Kardashian's house in Robert Kardashian's daughter's bedroom, and the daughter was a younger girl at that time named Kim. So we had no idea who this Kim was and who Robert Kardashian was, but that was the introduction to the world of Kim Kardashian and the rest of the Kardashians. And yeah. Ironically enough, because O.J. wanted his kids to not necessarily be hounded by the paparazzi over the course of all of the circus of events. But O.J. Simpson passing away yesterday, actually. And then you had the weird thing of Adam Schefter sending a tweet about it. But then I went and looked, and O.J. Simpson's Twitter account, or X, or whatever you want to call it now, but had sent out a statement about O.J. Simpson's passing. Adam Schefter basically hit copy and paste on that and sent it out. And then ABC News sent one that was an exact copy and paste of the way that Adam Schefter basically had worded it, to which Adam Schefter reposted ABC, reposting Adam Schefter, which was just a copy and paste from O.J. Simpson. What a world we live in, right? What the hell are we doing? What's going on with Kentucky, Jimmy?
Look, Jake, this is the school that from Kentucky fans that I've talked to, from any interaction you have with Big Blue Nation on Twitter, it's they can get whoever they want. And granted, in fairness to them, one of the three names I'm about to list, we knew was never going to go there because of the great situation that he has up in the Northeast. But Dan Hurley, strike one. Nate Oates, strike two. Scott Drew, strike three. They're 0-3 on this coaching carousel. And I was under the impression that this was the program where they have all the prestige and the legacy and all the money you could ever hope for, and they get who they want. Three strikes, you're out to this point for Big Blue Nation.
Okay, so I'm going to push back on that a little bit. You're forgetting a key component here.
Okay.
Who's the biggest name in college basketball?
Probably Coach Cal. Okay. Probably John Calipari.
Right. Right. Who's the biggest brand amongst coaches in college basketball?
Yeah, I would say Coach Cal.
Okay. When Kentucky, better question. Who did John Calipari replace in Kentucky?
I don't remember.
Right.
Yeah.
Billy Gillespie.
Yeah.
So they had Tubby Smith, won a national championship, goes south. Tubby Smith is, I think he was terminated. I can't remember if it was that or it was a mutual agreement, but nonetheless, Tubby Smith still, though, you know, at the time, big name, his son's on the staff, the whole deal. They went out and they got Billy Gillespie, who was kind of a rising star at that time, and they knew right away it didn't work out. And I think he was there 2 years. And then they go out and they get Calipari, right? And so there was even though Gillespie was a big rising name, he was not a national championship pedigreed coach. I'm not saying Tubby Smith was Rick Pitino, but it's never easy to follow the legend. Like Alabama, they went out and got a guy who was not necessarily an established long-term head coaching hire to replace Nick Saban. They weren't going to get Dabo Swinney. They weren't going to get, I'm not saying they wanted him, but you know, they weren't going to get Jim Harbaugh. They weren't going to get Ryan Day because those guys are like, Saban was a brand. So that's the challenge Kentucky has. What I'm saying is Kentucky, though, made – Kentucky is different than a lot of places in the fact that – who. Part two of this question, Jimmy, would be this. If you right now, if Jimmy Cook University was starting tomorrow and you were starting a college basketball program and they said, we're going to give you $10 million a year for the coach and you got to pick three coaches, what three coaches are you going after?
Cal would be on that list.
Okay.
Mark Few would be on that list.
Okay. Danny Hurley wouldn't?
Yeah, Hurley would be there, sure.
And and Nate Oates would be high on the list, right?
Sure.
So my point being, Kentucky, they didn't mess around. Kentucky's like, we're going right for the top. We're going to swing right at the top. Now, because it's Calipari, I think that's a huge part of why those guys aren't going to take that job, because it's like, well, to replace a legend. But Kentucky is not afraid to swing and go after it. And we don't know for certain that they're not going to counter and come back and sweeten the pot even more.
And they very well could. And if they do, I'll applaud them. But the reason I push back on that slightly, I agree with half of what you're saying. Coach Cal is a brand, but they're not, like, to the Saban point you made. Saban, even though it had been a couple of years, had a gauntlet of national titles that he achieved for Alabama, reestablished them as a high level, no bones about it, since the Bear Bryant days, dynasty. Those are shoes you do not want to fill. Yes, Coach Cal's brand can be overwhelming, but they haven't won a title in 12 years,
Understood. And
they haven't been to a Final
Understood.
Four in 9. So it's not like you're following this aura of untouchability when really all your bar has to be in year one is, hey, make it out of the first round, because they haven't been able to do that in 3 years.
No, I mean, you're right about that. I saw yesterday, it was funny, one of the big Arkansas accounts kept mocking Kentucky, like making fun of Kentucky. Like, in the last 5 years, Arkansas has been to 2 Sweet 16s, and Kentucky hasn't been out of round one or whatever. And people are like, you realize that you're throwing shade on the guy you just hired, right? I mean, so there is that.
Yeah.
But he still is a major brand. Now, the one – I did think of this last night. Whatever happened to World Wide West? Remember World Wide West?
Yeah, I do.
There was like a 2-year window where everything for Kentucky that they touched turned to gold because World Wide West was the connection. Like Jay-Z and World Wide West were funneling players to Calipari and they were getting whoever they wanted. Whatever happened to World Wide West? Where is he?
Found him.
What is he now, like County Wide West?
Do you want to guess what he's doing? He's in the NBA, I'll tell you that.
He is the Director of Player Personnel and Development for the Los Angeles Clippers.
That is a great guess. He is the – you want another one or you want me to just –
I'll go one more.
Okay.
World Wide West is the
– Wrong coast.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. He is the marketing and merchandising brand development for the New York Knickerbockers.
So you got one of two right there. He is the executive vice president – senior basketball advisor for the New York Knicks.
Okay. What does senior basketball advisor mean? You advise about basketball?
I would say so, at a senior level. Your voice carries more than the junior basketball advisor.
Now, here's the thing. If he is doing that with the New York Knicks.
Sure.
And the New York Knicks still have people within, and I know this for a fact, the New York Knicks still have people within the organization that are supporters and have allegiance to one of their former coaches who's now in college, then why is World Wide West not helping out players and why is Indiana not benefiting from the fact that World Wide West is in the biggest media market for an NBA team?
All great questions.
But he was the deal, remember?
Sure, yes.
World Wide West was like, oh, well, yeah, that I don't know if you heard, but that coach got fired. Why? Well, because he was in a concession stand line and he saw World Wide West and didn't say hi to him, so they fired him. I mean, it was unbelievable for a while there.
Yeah. It's crazy. Jay-Z put him, this is only 8 years ago, but Jay-Z put him in a song, like it referenced him.
Totally.
In a song.
Are you surprised that Mason Gillis is in the transfer portal?
I am a little bit. Maybe I shouldn't be because there's a high-level amount of recruits coming into Purdue next year. And, leading that list is Cannon Catchings, Tamika's son. So maybe I should be a little bit less surprised than I am, but I think that for as much as he meant to that team and the thought that, look, I'm in the camp that Purdue, and you and I have talked about this off air, Jake, who is to say that this isn't the run Purdue just went on? Who's to say that's not the shattering of the glass that in 2, 3, 4 years they make it right back there and they make a deep run? I don't think that's happening next year, in part because that would be quite a turnaround to lose the best player in college basketball the last 2 years and then immediately make it back to the Final Four. Like, that's tip of the cap across the board in ways we haven't previously with Matt Painter and others. But with that thought and that belief when you buy into a team and how important Mason Gillis was both on the floor and his leadership, I would have thought he would have been the type that would run it back, that would want to close things out at Purdue. So that aspect surprised me. Were you taken aback by it, or is this just, that is the nature of the beast? Sometimes, whether you're a senior or junior, and him having a COVID year, having 1 year of eligibility left, like, I get it. Makes sense. Maybe have one more bite at the apple somewhere else.
Yeah, here's the thing. It is not, and this is a knock on no one, right?
It is Tamika's nephew, by the way. I apologize. Cannon Catchings, not her son.
It's Tamika's sister's son, right?
Yep.
The reality is this, and this is not a knock on Mason Gillis nor Purdue. I mean, and I think Mason Gillis will probably say this. Mason Gillis next year, if he were to stay at Purdue with the extra year, could he be a starter? Yeah, probably. But starting him for 1 year does not long-term help Purdue, especially when you have like Catchings. Catchings is a very promising player. He's bigger. I don't know if he's that level of outside shooter. Gillis is kind of a unique player because of his strength, but at the same time, his touch from the outside. But my point being, I don't know how much it helps you in terms of Purdue basketball moving forward to have a guy that is in his last year that you bring back that would take minutes from your now reset, if you will, of like another 2-year run or 2-year window, sure. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
And, the other thing, Lawyer is probably cemented as a starter, but would Lawyer be better served coming off as a sixth man so that you can get more athleticism at that position right out of the box, and in particular defensively, you know, maybe that's – again, it depends. They have a very good class coming in, and they have a lot of players in that class. And, you know, Gillis may say, look, I want to go somewhere where I can see if I can get 20. I had somebody from Indiana actually ask me this year. They said, is there a school in the Big Ten that Mason Gillis would not lead in scoring if he were to transfer? I mean, outside of Illinois and probably Indiana, but where he wouldn't put up at least 15 a game if he had transferred within the Big Ten, theoretically speaking, in the middle of the year. Point being, there were a lot of shots at Purdue, and his role was not necessarily to get one of those. I mean, obviously, you know, shots 1, 2, and 3 are going to Edie, right? And, you know, maybe he just decided, hey, I want to go somewhere and see if I can get up 15, 18 a game and see what that does for me in terms of my profile playing basketball after college. Entirely possible. Dick Gabriel in Lexington going to join us next. We'll find out. He just sent me a text that said, well, things just got really interesting. It's exactly what he just said to me. Things just got really interesting. All right. Well, we're going to find out exactly why that is and how it might affect, say, Indiana and Purdue. We'll bring that into the conversation next.
Spring in Indy.
Big Blue Insider 1 is the, I still say Twitter, X.
Still say Twitter. It's
account,
fine.
I know. For Dick Gabriel, my friend down in Lexington. You can hear him each night, 6 until 8 o'clock on 630 WLAP, also at UK Sports Network. He joins us now to talk about everything going on in Lexington. And, Dick, I will let you pay off the tees, if you will, to use a radio term, because I had mentioned that just before we were about to have you on, you basically texted me and said, well, things just got real interesting. And we're talking about, of course, the Kentucky coaching search. So give us the latest on what's going on in Bluegrass Country.
Scott Drew says thanks, but no thanks, which I don't know how many people expected that, but and you guys have been involved in things like this. I know coaching searches, everybody comes an expert on the tail numbers of airplanes and tracking and things like that. And we were told, or somebody said, the plane's coming from Waco. We assumed Drew was coming in. No, he sent his family, his wife and I don't know how many kids to check out Lexington. And they were diverted when they found out there were a bunch of media people here. But the bottom line is, from what I was just told by a friend of mine down in Waco, Scott Drew's wife is very, very private and was beginning to learn just how much of a three-ring circus life would be up here. Even if she didn't go out publicly a lot in Lexington to be the coach's wife. And she didn't want that. And also their children are high school and college age. Very difficult to convince them to leave your friends behind, leave the prom behind, all of that, and pick up and move. Drew apparently is intensely devoted to his family as well as his faith, which is not a drawback. But the family part, yeah. So they said no, and Scott Drew said no thank you, even though, guys, there wasn't an official offer. They play that game. I'm sure it's like, if we offered, would you be interested, that kind of thing. But as I understand it, they never firmly made an offer, but they never do until the last minute. So now where do you go?
Do you believe Drew was Drew target one or target two?
I think in Mitch Barnhart's mind and heart, he was target one because he had gotten to know Scott Drew. And it's like a buddy of mine said, when Mitch Barnhart looks in the mirror, he sees Drew's reflection in terms of their values, their family, their faith and all that. I think that Drew best typifies what Mitch Barnhart would like.
Mitch Barnhart's the athletic director, correct?
Yeah, that's correct. Okay. That's correct. And what he's got to balance that against, of course, what's best for the program. So they had reached out to Billy Donovan. They had reached out to Hurley. And now, as I understand it, they're turning back to at least those two guys.
So Dick Gabriel is our guest in Lexington. We were talking about this earlier, and you know it better than anybody, certainly better than I. But I have always said that the thing that I respect about Kentucky and Kansas is that when there's a coach they want, man, it is all things in on getting that coach. That doesn't mean that you're going to land on your first swing. But coming off of John Calipari, how big an obstacle is that in the fact that you are asking someone to come in and immediately replace one of the icons of the era in college basketball, as opposed to getting somebody that might be an intermediary and then getting the long-term guy?
I think that's the question, Jake. And here's the thing. You're not only replacing the icon, a guy who's larger than life, but also a guy whose timeline here, to be fair, sputtered down the stretch here the last 4 or 5 years, and the fan base turned on him. And that has only been exacerbated by social media. It's a different time now. It's a different world. And so coaches can sit back and say, gosh, I don't want to be the guy who replaces John Calipari, who went to 4 Final Fours in 6 years and won a title. They also say, I don't want to deal with that mess. I don't want to deal, as you kids say, with all that smoke, if I'm using that right. So now you've got guys who would love the paycheck. But right now, there are so many coaches making big bucks anyhow that they don't have to abandon where they are to make a cash grab. And aren't that many guys who would get that opportunity, quite frankly. But somebody might, if and when Hurley says no, or his people, and if and when Billy Donovan says no, or Billy says, I can't do anything to the end of the NBA season, and Kentucky can't wait that long.
Dick, admittedly, I don't have friends that are in the market that cover all things Kentucky. I have friends that are Kentucky fans that have gone through the same emotions that you outlined over the last 4 or 5 years where things have sputtered with Cal. But all I hear from them post Calipari is, we're Kentucky. We get everybody we want. We'll give them money. We're the most prestigious program in the land, and everything's going to work out. At what point, or maybe it is just the shadow of Cal's too big, and in 4 years or 2 years, they'll have their guy. But at what point do we hear all these, you know, dances around trying to get a Hurley or a Drew or an Oates, and they come up snake eyes? Does it become, well, maybe people really don't want to deal with all that. Maybe they can't get whoever they want. Or are we not even close to that conversation?
You're right. You know what? I'm amazed that people still think that. And you're right. After the Billy Gillespie saga, because he was not the first choice. It was Billy Donovan. And believe it or not, after that was Rick Barnes, but he was waiting on Kevin Durant. They couldn't wait any longer. Then they turned to Gillespie, who at the time was hot property. Although a couple of people were like, why are you hiring this guy? But everybody else thought grand slam, and it didn't work. That should have been a lesson that the Big Blue Nation learned back then. Heck, when they hired Eddie Sutton, they had Gene Bartow had turned them down. So that happens. You know how it is. People have short memories, and those memories are often clouded by their own egos or their arrogance. We're Kentucky. We should get whoever we want. Somebody called in one of the shows and said, why don't we just go into a school and say, we're taking your coach? That ain't how it works, especially now when coaches have more leverage.
Yeah, and with that, I keep going back to, Dick, it is the way that it ended. I mean, whoever would have guessed? I think the thing that really hurts Kentucky, and I'm speaking from an outsider perspective, so I want you to tell me if you think I'm off base. I think one of the things that hurt Kentucky is once you saw that Arkansas did not match what he was making at Kentucky, that causes somebody outside of the Lexington area to go, wait a minute. He was willing to go from Lexington, Kentucky to Fayetteville, Arkansas for less money? So then why in the world, why would I want to go there then? Even though it's a ton of money. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Why you would want to go there is you're probably going to make more than what you're making now. But I think that if you have kept an eye on what was happening at Kentucky, and especially since this past season ended, and the way Calipari has stubbornly refused to change the way he does things, then if you're really up to speed on what's happening here, you realize that it was time for a change. He has all but said, at least he did here, I'm not going to change the way I'm building my roster. I'm still going to commit to as many talented freshmen as I have. And then the unsaid thing is, and then we'll work the portal after that. And as you guys know, that's not the way it's working anymore. One freshman in the Final Four, maybe 10 or 12 in the entire Sweet 16. And last year, no McDonald's All-Americans in the Final Four at all. The portal has radically changed college basketball, and Calipari refused to change with it because he was so successful leaning on one and dones. Well, that as Jay Wright put it, I don't know if you saw it, but in a 2-minute and 47-second soundbite after Kentucky's loss, he absolutely crystallized what's going on in college basketball now. And the unspoken thing was, and here's what Calipari needs to do. So if you're a coach looking from the outside in, you're thinking, okay, I know how to work it now. He wasn't doing it, but I know what needs to be done.
Lexington's own Dick Gabriel is our guest. You can follow him on Twitter at BigBlueInsider1. Dick, you mentioned this earlier, and it's very common within my generation, especially because of how prevalent social media has been growing up. But oftentimes you hear, and Indiana's dealt with it as well. They dealt with it with the fallout of losing Liam McNeely with his decommitment a month or so ago, of toxicity of a fan base, or a fan base being too rabid and out there and aggressive to the point that why would you want to deal with that on a day-to-day? And I've always thought, to some extent, if you're in a position of higher power where you're getting paid a lot of money, yes, there's stresses of the job, but the money helps offset that a little bit where you can cloud out the noise to some extent. Is that, do you feel that in Lexington, that that fan base, much like IU's, is so rabid and so at times can be nasty, that that would be a turnoff to a candidate?
Absolutely. And I go back to your original questions. I think that that's one of the reasons that Scott Drew's family, or at least his wife, didn't want it. And it's that way everywhere. You make a great point about social media. I put the first sports talk show, for better or worse, on the air here in Lexington in 1980, and people ask me about the difference between then and now, and my first word is respect. Back then, people, they might criticize a coach, but they would, if it was possible, kind of do it respectfully. And now, hiding behind the wall of anonymity, well, they lash out at a moment's notice, and they don't have to call the talk show to do it. They just jump online and say whatever they feel like saying, and it, you know, and it just piles up. There's no question. And yeah, I keep hearing, well, for that kind of money, fill in the blank, you know, they, and to your point, they ought to be able to take it. But people are human. And Calipari, I think one of his problems of late was a disconnect with the fans. And it could have been that he just decided, I'm not going to look at it, listen to it, watch it. I'm just going to do my thing. But that's never healthy. And so the guy who did his best to connect with the fans when he got here, I think had fallen out of touch with them. But if you go back and look at his comments after the SEC tournament loss, after the Oakland loss in the NCAA tournament, he talked a lot about how bad he felt for the fans. But I think it kind of rang hollow at that point.
Dick, did you ever, have you ever taught classes in your career? You have, haven't you?
A little bit, yeah.
So we did an exercise yesterday. I'd like for you to grade us, okay?
Okay.
We did a thing where we each said we're going to write down a name in an envelope, and then we're going to open it up once Kentucky makes a hire, and if one of us was correct, we get $1 million, which would be secondary to getting an A from you, okay? Jimmy, you said who?
I said Scott Drew.
So is it too early to say definitively that Jimmy's answer is an F?
No, I think, I'm sorry, Jimmy, but
<That's okay. laughs>
going into this morning, I would have given you an A+, but you just bottomed out.
It's all right. That happens. My college career right there.
I believe Eddie said Mark Few, did he not? Or did he say Billy Donovan?
I think he said Few.
Okay. Mark Few was Eddie's answer.
Mark Few's name has never come up. And you guys, didn't he say when Indiana went after him, I'm a Pacific Northwest guy?
Something like that.
Hey, Mark Few's got it figured out, right, Dick?
Oh, like, he said, sorry. You know what I mean?
Oh,
sorry.
My gosh.
I don't mean to cut across both of you, but our producer, Eddie Garrison, is on vacation now. I just texted him. Mick Cronin was his
guest. Mick Cronin. Okay, there you go. Mick Cronin. So what would you grade Eddie?
Well, right now, an incomplete. Because his name hasn't come up, but that doesn't mean it won't.
I don't see him.
That's not a good fit here, I don't think.
Here's the guy. Now, I'm telling you, Dick, you know, you and I have become buddies, right? You don't even have to credit me on this if you don't want. You know what I mean? Like, you're big blue insider one, but I'm going to make you big blue insider 1.0 A+. You ready?
Yeah.
The guy that is the perfect fit for Kentucky in every aspect, every avenue, and the guy that I think would crawl to get there, and he knows the conference well, not once but twice, Bruce Pearl, baby. Grade me.
That's not a bad answer at all. And to me, and it's unfortunate because he's only a little older than I am, the only thing working against him is age. He's 69.
Is he really? That guy's 69 going on 45, isn't he?
Thank you. Yes. And I can tell you, like I said, now this was a while ago, but when they hired Billy G, they first called Rick Barnes. And Rick's thing was, look, I'm waiting to hear from Kevin Durant. He's going to tell us this weekend if he's going pro. If he goes pro, I'm your man. If he comes back, I want to coach him some more. But if you can give me till Monday or Sunday night, I'm your man. And they said, no, signing day's coming up Friday. We've got to sign Patrick Patterson. I need an answer now. And he said, I'm sorry. And the next thing you know, they called Billy Clyde.
And I think, I think the world of Rick Barnes, but I mean, my mom knew that Kevin Durant was going pro. Like, how does he not know that, right?
Hope against hope, I guess. I guess. I don't know.
All right, now let me ask you this, Dick. Dick Gabriel in Lexington, our guest. In terms of how this impacts, if at all, our local audience, and we'll go with both schools here, I'll begin with the Indiana side of it. Indiana and Kentucky have agreed now to you know, the baby steps of bringing back what you and I have talked about, which is one of the great traditions for both our states and sports in December. With how much of that was Cal that was blocking it being like the Assembly Hall and Rupp Arena thing? Whoever comes in, does this now mean that there is a retweak and maybe even an extension of the Indiana-Kentucky, even like neutral courts, whatever it might be, series?
I think it's got to be on the table and quickly, because you and I are in lockstep on this. It needs to happen, not at neutral sites or Indianapolis and Louisville, whatever. It needs to happen home and home. And it was Calipari driving that bus and Mitch Barnhart, the AD, supporting his coach, you know, which he's supposed to do. But I've told you this, the silliest thing of all about that was that loss in Assembly Hall motivated that Kentucky team for the rest of the year, because ESPN rightly played that clip of that shot by Christian Watford in its lead promo. Well, if you're ESPN, of course you're going to do that. That's your most valuable piece of video that you own. You and I have worked in TV. You work that stuff to death.
Right.
And the Kentucky kids saw it whenever they watched another college game. Here's the ESPN promo with Indiana beating Kentucky. And they told us many times that motivated them through the NCAA tournament to the championship. But, yeah, things got crazy after the game. You can fix that. And they need to fix this rivalry.
You mentioned Jay Wright, Dick. In conclusion, I wanted to ask you this for our friends that are listening that are also Purdue fans. You know, Jay Wright was a guy that people were like, he's got a great program, but they can't break through. And then he did, right? And he did. And I think now people can look back and say, to me, Jay Wright just absolutely drips everything that's right about college basketball, and you just can't help but have respect for him. From the outside perspective, you're in Lexington, you're covering Kentucky, you're covering the SEC. Just your thoughts on Matt Painter, where that Purdue program is, and if, in fact, Purdue has broken through where they now sustain in college basketball's elite.
Many years ago, when we were all down here playing the game, what happens when whoever leaves? I heard that name. I heard Matt Painter. And people are like, who? I said, keep an eye on this guy at Purdue. To answer your question, I would think so. Because now they're back on there. And I grew up, man, I remember when Purdue came to Freedom Hall and played in the Final Four. I watched Rick Mount play in the ABA. Yep. So, you know, there is tradition there. But I think it was a guy like Painter. And, boy, you talk about respected. And he proved how good a coach he is with his adjustments. And, yeah, he had a Matt Eady. But, you know, it takes a lot more than that. So, to answer your question in a short answer, yes, I think you're exactly right.
Dick, you ever been to Mammoth Cave?
I have.
So I had never been to Claiborne Farms. I mentioned it on the air, and then one day I asked you about it, and you said, well, let's just go and meet, and we had a fun day together. I've never been to Mammoth Cave. Is that our next field trip? You want to meet me at Mammoth Cave?
If that's what you want, brother. But are you claustrophobic at all?
Not really. And, well, I mean, if I got to get down and, like, spelunk and, like through a tube, I'm not all for that.
You could. That's available. I ain't doing that because I am claustrophobic. But I can go to Mammoth Cave. I was a chaperone for my kids' class, sixth grade class. I can do Mammoth Cave. I'm not doing what they call fat man's misery, where you got to crawl through holes.
I'm not going to lie to you, Dick. I'm not claustrophobic, but I do have phobia of being in tight, confined areas with more than one Kentucky fan. So it depends on
– I don't blame you.
Depends on who's there, right? Scott Drew and I have that in common, apparently.
Hey, man, I was in China with a group of friends, and at one point on an overnight train, this guy goes, I just got to ask you, what about our recruiting process? I'm like, Larry, we're on the other side of the world. Let's let it go for a while.
Yeah, I get it. That's why it's called Big – it's not just Big Blue Nation. It's Big Blue Multination, apparently.
That's exactly right.
Dick, we appreciate it, man. I know it's going to be a busy week for you here, so enjoy the madness that goes along with the coaching search at one of the Blue Bloods of college basketball.
No problem. Thanks. Good to talk to you.
Likewise. I'll hit you up on Mammoth Cave. We're going to do it. That's Dick Gabriel, our friend down in Lexington. All right, so we got to shift gears a little bit, go to the professional side, which is always weird to say when you're talking about Kentucky. Literally, it's just kind of a parallel step. But we'll get into the Pacers discussion coming up.
Heat and cool with nearly geothermal efficiency in places you can't fit ductwork.
This song prominently featured in what 2000 era film? Grossly underrated movie.
TMNT. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Is it in that as well?
Oh, yeah, it is. Oh, yeah, it is.
So that's where, isn't also, Baltimora. What's the name of the song? It's hard to do with the song in your head. Jungle Life.
Yeah.
All Alone. Like Tarzan Boy by Baltimore. Isn't that also in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
I believe so, yes.
Come on, guys. Work with me here.
I told you I believe so, yes. I can't firmly say yes.
Did you guys watch
then,
Power Rangers?
Not as much, but I am familiar
with Power Rangers. I don't know what era that is, but
that's
guy
in that era.
That's
90s.
My best buddy in kindergarten and first grade, and then he moved after first grade, Selwyn Ward. He's one of the Power Rangers.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Do you know which one?
Which one of the Power Rangers?
Well, they wear different colors. I don't know their names. There's a red Power Ranger,
I think
pink
he's
Power
a
Ranger,
blue one.
Blue Power Ranger.
I think
okay.
he's
a,
right. the blue one. Okay. He's also in the Blue Man Group, by the way, on the weekend.
How about that?
Yeah, what are the odds of that? That song, by the way, was in Blow, which is great with Johnny Depp. Okay. Very good movie. Bob Kravitz going to join us next. We've got a cornucopia of topics to get to with the writer Bob Kravitz, one of the longstanding media members, of course, in Indianapolis. That conversation next.
Let Bill Estes put you behind the wheel of the powerhouse brand.
Listening to Query and Company on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Our next guest needs no introduction, although I'll do it, to the Indianapolis market. He is, we often say that Mike Chappell's the dean of football coverage I have always thought Bob Kravitz is the dean just in terms of overall media within Indianapolis. You can always read his column, Musings of an Old Sports Writer, on Substack. And we will get you that exact. BobKravitz.com, I'll make it easy, is the website to do so. But more importantly, before we get to all of that, I want to allow Bob to mention the fact that he has an upcoming event that is going to give you the opportunity to play one of the great golf courses at Prairie View. This is going to be on July the 8th. So, Bob, before we get to the wide array of sports, please tell us what it is that you are putting on that is just now under 3 months away.
Yes, thank you for asking. July 8th at Prairie View Golf Course in Carmel, my home course, our 12th annual, I can't believe it's 12 years, 12th annual ALS Golf Classic, Celebrity Golf Classic. And we have a great time and we raise money for a wonderful cause. And I lost my mom to that disease in 2007. So I do this in her memory and her honor.
And I would imagine that all of the information just in terms of where one can sign up or make donations and help out the cause is on your website, correct?
It is. I actually just put the link on Twitter. I will put it on my website here in the next couple of hours. Yes.
Okay. So again, the Twitter account, X, whatever you want to call it, at B Kravitz, K-R-A-V-I-T-Z.
Correct.
July 8th, Prairie View Golf Course, everything shotgun start, 11 a.m. Okay, so
you
speaking of shotgun
Thank
start,
you.
Bob, I'll let you have a shotgun start on topic of conversation. We got Purdue, we got Pacers, we got Colts, we got Fever. You want which?
Let's go. Oh, my dog's barking. Let's start with Purdue.
What's your doggie's name?
Espo.
Expo or Espo?
Espo, E-S-P-O.
What kind of doggie is Espo?
Espo is a part terrier and what the heck is he? Chihuahua.
Okay. So Espo has a lot of energy is what we're getting at, right?
Espo is a yappy little dog, much like his owner.
Fair enough. That's correct. All right. So which category did you go with to begin?
I went with Purdue.
Okay. I thought, Bob, the real interesting thing here, I think there were people that were surprised by Mason Gillis going into the portal, although when you really step back and look at it, it does kind of make sense.
Sure.
Just your thoughts, I guess, to put a tie on or a bow, better yet, on their season and what your expectation is now and how they carry forward the progress made within the program.
Well, I mean, yeah, they've got some terrific young players. I think Heidi is going to be something special. I think Colvin is going to be very good. I wouldn't be completely surprised if he supplants Fletcher Lawyer at some point. They have the 13th best recruiting class coming in. So I see no reason. I mean, look, they're not going to be the team they were the last 2 years, but I see no reason why they can't continue to be one of the elite teams in the Big Ten. Absolutely. Like I said, you know, the recruiting class is very strong. You know, they're going to lose a few people to the portal, but to me, you know, I mean, Ethan Morton never played. Gillis is a tough loss, but you know, who can blame him? It's a chance to get some more NIL money. It's a chance to play significant minutes. He's a starter on virtually every other team in this country. So, good for him.
Bob, I was going through some old sports stuff that I had a week or two ago before this run really got to its apex, and one of them was a copy of the paper from both Butler Bulldogs runs to the Final Four and the National Championship game in 2010 and 2011, and I realized that the stakes there are different for a power program and a, at the time, mid-major program, but you wrote columns for both of those runs and, you know, Musing of an Old Sports Writer still on, you know, Substack, doing the same with Purdue. What, if any, parallels did you see for both fan bases, community, and team of those two Butler runs and Purdue finally breaking through to get to the Final Four once again and ultimately fall in the national title game?
Well, Purdue was just a complete shock. I meant Purdue. Butler was just a complete shock. You know, we knew that they were good, but, you know, playing in the Horizon League, we didn't know how good. Purdue, this was expected. I mean, UConn and Purdue have been circling each other all year long, and I think most of us probably got that right in our bracket that it'll be UConn and Purdue. It was different, again, because of the surprise element, it just kind of, but I think both of them got the whole state caught up. Maybe Butler more so, because Butler got the IU and Purdue people on the same page. I don't know how how Indiana people felt about the Purdue run. I would hope that they'd be happy for them, but I know better. But I'll tell you what, I used to tell David Woods this all the time. Covering those two Purdue runs were as much fun as I've ever had in journalism, because they were wonderful teams, great kids. Not that Purdue wasn't, but...
You mean the two Butler runs?
Two Butler runs, excuse me. Yes, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Bob, I thought for Purdue, you know, it's like anything else when you build step by step, right? And then you look at, with each level, with each rung, with each plateau, you think to yourself, like, well, it can't get better than this. And I have to remind myself that, I mean, Edie was obviously a generational player for them. But then I look back and I go, you know, I mean, when they had Hummel and Moore and Johnson, you thought, gosh, how can you get better than that group? And maybe Matt Painter now has to kind of redesign the way their identity is offensively, or will they have, do you believe that they have another big in waiting that they can build on? Or does it now have to become more of a wing and guard oriented program?
Well, I think, you know, with Berg coming in, he's already in, obviously, but with him becoming more of a player, I think as long as they go out and get 7-footers, they're going to be a center-related team. But, you know, you look back at that 2019 team, you know, with Carson Edwards and Ryan Klein and those guys, they weren't center specific. They were a team that you know, relied on shooting and wings and 3-point shots. So I think that, I mean, he's a smart coach, and he's going to take his best players and build around it. And if his best players are guys who aren't centers next year, I think it'll be a somewhat different approach to offense.
Bob Kravitz is our guest. Bob, let's shift to the Pacers. You know, the peak for the Pacers this year probably was the hype and the excitement and the buzz, certainly from a national standpoint, the spotlight that went into the play-in tournament. And then, you know, you make the trade. I'm not going to say they regressed, but I think they had to kind of re-find their footing. Have they found it? Do you think
they're playing great.
I was going to say, is this the best they've played since then?
Absolutely. And I think the decision earlier in the season to change the starting lineup, become a little more defensive-oriented, I think – they have figured out how to play with Pascal Siakam. I mean, they were such a ball movement team, and they still are. But with Pascal, you gotta slow the offense down a little bit to get him to his spots where he can score and be effective. So I think they're playing some of their best basketball of the season, aside from maybe the in-season tournament. They've been terrific. Obi Toppin's been really good. I mean, it's amazing to me to think that before the season began or on opening night, Rick Carlisle got very emotional talking about how he couldn't find room in the rotation for TJ McConnell, and now this is a guy who, you know, is going to get some consideration for sixth man of the year. He's been just unbelievable.
I mean, the last 3 weeks, he's on a whole different level, right?
Whole nother level. It's amazing. I mean, you heard LeBron say it the other day. He's his favorite player in the NBA right now. I mean, he changes the geometry of the game with the way he gets those paint touches.
Taking the Boston Celtics out of the conversation, and I know that's hard to do because they've been clearly the best team in the East and many picked them to win the title this year, but looking at the Pacers compared to the rest of the Eastern Conference, Bob, is there a clear ceiling on how far they can go?
No, not at all, especially with as well as they're playing. But you look in New York, they lost Randle. You look at the Heat, they're not playing well suddenly. You look at Milwaukee. Milwaukee hasn't been right since they changed coaches. Who am I forgetting? I think Orlando is probably the
New York. Did you mention New York?
Yeah, New York lost Randle. Philadelphia,
yeah.
You know, is just getting back in Embiid. So I think it's very possible they could get to the second round. Now, I mean, could they lose in the first round to say Orlando? Yeah, I mean, Orlando is a really tough matchup for them because of their size, but. I could see the Pacers making a nice little run here in these playoffs because they're playing as good a basketball as anybody in the Eastern Conference right now.
Bob, I have to remind myself of this, and you tell me if this is me being too naive or optimistic. Okay, I have to continuously remind myself of what the expectation was, not even necessarily at the beginning of this year, but at the beginning of last year, and that we felt like this was a three-year rebuild, and they've accelerated beyond that. But realistically, this year, the goal should have been, at the beginning of the year, you would have said, hey, get into a playoff series, not a play-in, but a playoff series, and go deep into that series just so your young players understand the elevation that happens in the playoffs, and then next year you really push in and go from there. I have to temperate myself, if that makes sense. Does that make sense what I'm saying?
No, I think it's realistic. I think it's very realistic right now. They've owned Milwaukee. They've done fine against New York, Cleveland. I'm not sure what their situation is right now, but there's nobody in the Eastern Conference aside from the Boston Celtics who I look at and say they got no chance. Boston's in a different world, but you look at Milwaukee, Cleveland, New York, everybody else. They're right there record wise. I mean, everybody's at 46, 47 wins right now. So I think this is a team with the way that it's playing. And the way the bench is planned, that could really give anybody outside of Boston a hell of a series.
What position is Chris Ballard going to draft?
I hope he does something he never does, which is move up in the draft and goes and gets himself Brock Bowers, the tight end. That said, he'll probably stay where he is or go back, and he'll get himself a cornerback.
Yeah, I could see.
That's my guess.
But Bob, this is what I keep saying, and I'm sure people listening probably get tired of me saying this, but I want you to tell me if it makes sense or if you agree. If you stay where you are, and let's say Bowers is not there, then to me, you have, let's say, three positions. Wide receiver, well, probably tight end, and corner, okay?
Mm-hmm.
The tiebreaker to me of those positions is the one that has the most drop off from round one to round two, and that's who you take with one. In other words,
right.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So if because receiver, yeah. You've got depth in round two, right?
Right. Receiver, we see this is one of the deepest receiving drafts we are told in many years. So you can definitely get your wide receiver in the second round. Now, unless you fall in love with with Brian Thomas from LSU or one of those guys. I would rather see them go on the offense. I'd like to see them do what the other teams in the division have done and surround the young quarterback on a rookie contract, surround him with weapons because they don't have enough now. But I have a feeling they're going to go cornerback and go get themselves the wide receiver in the second, third round.
Bob, do you find it jarring that, to your point you just mentioned, the last four off seasons, give or take, a team like Jacksonville or this year, a team like Houston has seen their young quarterback and realized, you know what, we need to be accelerating his development as much as possible. Let's do just that. Let's go out in free agency and let's find some offensive weapons, or let's prioritize offense with the first or second round pick, depending on where you're at on your draft board. Are you surprised the Colts have bucked that trend, or is that more just the philosophy that Chris Ballard has publicly said he believes in?
You know, I wrote a column a couple of weeks ago saying this is the year that Chris Ballard's going to take the big swing, and I'm sitting here thinking, you idiot. I mean, he never does. What makes – I thought, you know, with the salary cap going up so much and with a quarterback on a rookie contract, he would spend significant amounts of money, and he didn't. Now, you know, those teams that brought in new players, they also lost some of their guys. So, you know, I understand what he's saying, but – You know, it's not like what he's been doing has worked. You know, I mean, if they were consistent playoff teams, I'd say, you know, don't go out in free agency. It's not the Pollyanna that we all wanted to think it should be. But what they're doing isn't working. I mean, they won one playoff game since he's here. They haven't won the AFC South since he's here. I mean, to me, guys, if Richardson is healthy and gets through the whole year okay, and they don't make the playoffs, to me, Ballard's got to go. I mean, it's 8 freaking years
I'm there with
without
you.
Winning the AFC South.
It's hard to argue that. I mean, and look, he Ballard got, and it's brilliant to me, but he got a pass for a couple of years off of decisions, sure, quite frankly, that were made by Ballard, right? I mean, you know, you kick the can when you – the Carson Wentz thing, we know what happened there. But then, you know, be it Rivers, be it Ryan, you bought yourself time. As soon as he – and I think Ballard knows it, does he not, Bob? Ballard knows that drafting Anthony Richardson meant the clock is officially started, right?
Yeah, one would have to think so. I mean, he's a pretty smart dude. He's pretty self-aware. He's got to know. I mean, I thought that he might be in a little bit of a situation where he felt like he had to go and make a move, you know, to maybe help with his job security. But he is stubborn, if nothing else. He stands for this approach. And if they don't get to the playoffs yet again, I see no way that you can justify bringing him back. I just don't.
Lastly, Bob, it is not our job. Bob Kravitz, our guest. BobKravitz.com, the website. Golf outing, Prairie View, July 8th at 11 a.m. Shotgun start. He will have on Twitter as well information about that. Matter of fact, he does right now at B Kravitz. Yeah. It is not our job to get excited or have rooting interests for teams that we cover. You know, we have to be objective and just write what we observe. But mm-hmm. even with that, for me, and I mean this almost more for the city than I do just even the franchise, there is a level of excitement to me because I can see it in other people about Caitlin Clark coming to Indianapolis. Your thoughts?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm working today on a story for Indianapolis Monthly on Caitlin Clark. She'll be the draft is Monday. She'll probably be in for a press conference next week. I just think it's awesome. I don't know what their ticket situation is just yet. I've got to imagine they're selling pretty quick. This is a once in a lifetime kind of opportunity for not just women's sports, but just sports in this town to have another transcendent superstar in our midst. And it's going to be great fun. I think it's great for the city. It's great for Herb and for that organization. You know, I'm sure that women's basketball has been a financial strain on ownership over the years, but now comes the payoff in Caitlin Clark.
And 36 of 40 games on national television.
Isn't that something?
And I'm going to maintain my $1 million idea. Actually, it's probably more like a $10,000 idea. That if you owned a small hotel along I-74, like around Decatur, Illinois, you should just paint the entire interior of the lobby in, like, Iowa and Fever gear, because the state of Iowa, 20 times, half the state of Iowa is going to be driving down 74. It's perfect.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Now, it's going to be fabulous. I'm looking forward to getting to know her a little bit. And if you, anybody has a chance, ESPN has a great story by my friend Wright Thompson about Caitlin Clark. It's the best thing I've seen written about her. So check that out.
Bob, we went to Springsteen together. Your next dream concert is who?
Well, I've never seen you two. I know you went out to Vegas to see them, so that must have been pretty outstanding.
It was great. And admittedly, he knows that his voice is not probably what it was in 1987, right? But that's where the crowd sings along. But it was a pretty good show.
Yeah. I kind of like to. Let's go to Vegas. What the hell?
They're done at the Sphere, though. You got to wait for them to come back. You can go to the Sphere and see Dead & Company or Fish at the Sphere, both of which might be putting your life in your own hands.
I think I'll hold off on that.
I mean,
that
a dude did a swan dive during learning to fly at Pink Floyd at the RCA Dome in 1987. I can only imagine what's going to happen in the Sphere, right? But
Exactly.
Bob, we appreciate the time as always, and we will have you on again a couple times to plug the golf outing before July 8th.
Sounds good. Appreciate it, man.
Bob Kravitz, our friend on the program. By the way, Jimmy, speaking of golf, let me just let everybody know right now. Jimmy, I don't even want you to look.
Okay.
Don't even look. Don't even look.
I already did. Okay.
Right now, the Masters is underway.
This is true. It is underway. A little bit of a weather delay out of the gate, but now they've been rolling since about 10 o'clock.
There are some names on the leaderboard.
Are there?
Yeah.
Any names that were beloved?
Justin
yesterday?
Thomas, shooting even. Ricky Fowler, even. Phil Mickelson, hefty lefty, right? He's even. Sergio Garcia, you might expect, even. Joaquin Neiman, we talked about yesterday, right? Joaquin just one under. Did I mention Justin Thomas? Even right now? How about Schwartzel? Former winner, right? Is he not?
Uncertain.
Three over. Oh, why even show up? Right now on the leaderboard. Oh, what do you know? Lurking already through 10.
Can you be lurking through 10 in the first round at Augusta? Is that possible?
Lurking on the leaderboard.
All right.
There are 5 golfers that are 3 under. And guess who is right behind him? Me.
If I was to take a guess, I would say it would be the budding legend
History
himself.
History has begun. The run is underway. You folks, if you were listening yesterday, heard me say it. You laughed. You mocked. Now you cry. Sitting right there at 2 under.
Oh, 2 under now.
Yes. 2 under. Santiago de la Fuente. Technically, it is listed as tied for 6. That's only because there are 5 that are 3 under. I say he's tied for 2nd.
Tied for 1st in our hearts.
I'm telling you.
Hey, do you have Will Haskett's number, by the way? Because if you don't, I want you to text him just updates throughout.
People can laugh all they want. And they were saying to themselves, how do I find Santiago de la Fuente? It's easy. You take a look at the leaderboard. You don't even have to touch the mouse. There's no scrolling involved. There he is.
Would you like to bring in Nathaniel and others that maybe did not catch your Nostradamus descendant?
Well, Nostradamus is my homie. I've said it before.
I figured descendant at this point. When
my day comes and I'm at the pearly gates, assuming if 50-50, that when I get there, St. Peter's going to – I'm going to pass the test, hopefully. I'm going to walk in, and right there on the first cloud, there stands a bearded man. And I'll say, that's a nice robe. Where did you get that? Oh, I've had it for quite some time. I've been here for a long time, but I've been waiting for you because you're my homie. Fist bump, Nostradamus. And he's going to say, I sent you my powers. And young lad, young Jedi, you did well. I heard a lot of your predictions that people laughed about on radio, and then more often than not, they came to be true. Now, you're not one of those that gets on radio the next day and is vociferous about the fact that you're always right, because nobody wants to hear that, right? We see what happens when people just go on and on about how they're right about everything. People get tired of it. But every once in a while, it's worth reminding. And so yesterday, when we were talking about who's going to win the Masters, I said, almost entirely because I think Something About Mary's a great movie, and I like Tucker, and he's been to Santiago, Chile, allegedly twice in 1 year. He's never even been in Jersey. And then, a great cigar, the Arturo Fuente. What do you know? Great movie, great cigar, great golfer. Santiago de la Fuente. Never mind. And I overlooked the 250,000 plus 250,000 odds, right? I put 20 on it. He wins, I get 50 grand. 50 grand.
That's pretty awesome.
50 grand. Now, the other side of things that I could do is take my Altura Fuente cigar, wrap it in a 20, and smoke it and just burn it in the same fashion. But I'm telling you, Santiago de la Fuente right now, 200. I probably shouldn't have said anything because the pressure might be mounting. But through 10, there he is.
Did you also bet him, and I realize the answer is no because you have the gifts of Nostradamus, and why would you do this? Because that would undercut your prediction. But did you also wager him to be the leading amateur? Like, I feel like that would have been a nice little double dip there for you.
Jimmy.
I'm just looking out for you. I feel like that would have been a good double dip.
Deductive reasoning.
Mm.
If I'm picking that this guy's going to win the Masters.
Yeah, exactly.
Then it kind of goes without saying that I think he's going to be the leading amateur, right?
It does, but why not cash in twice? That's all I'm saying.
That's fair. I mean, but that goes without saying. Now, granted, there is an amateur that right now is one stroke ahead of him, but that's short-lived. Christo Lamprecht, right? I mean, come on, how long is that going to last? That lamp is going to die out before noon tomorrow, I mean, not today.
The lamp is going to get wrecked is what you're saying?
Yeah, that lamp is like the eclipse, right? It's going to have a four-minute window.
And you're not
going
to get to see it.
Huh?
And you're not going to get to see it.
That's right. I'm telling you. Santiago, though. Santiago de la Fuente, 200, baby. The madness is underway at Augusta.
JMV here for my friends, John and Chris Love at Love Heating and Air Conditioning. Spring.
You do realize I'm just warning people now. You realize that the longer that our boy SDF sticks around, I will become completely insufferable.
Correct. I do. It was the same type of fear that I had building up. Well, not full fear at that point because my wife is a big Indiana fan, but the same type of fear that I had in the first quarter of IU Michigan at the Big House. Because we would never hear the end of it if Tom Allen.
This is different.
It's on different planes. I'm telling you, Santiago
has a focus that Tom Allen doesn't have.
That is fair, but I'm just telling you from the
SDF bigger than LEO.
From those that it could be impacted on, the vibes feel about the same as they did in that first quarter.
I'd like to thank yesterday. Let me see if I can run the number here and find out the name. Somebody sent me the picture of Santiago de la Fuente warming up and just said, it's the beginning of a historic week. Yes. I want everybody all in on Santiago de la Fuente?
I'm all in. I think it's a wild time, but I'm all in on it.
I remember vividly.
I'm all in because I like chaos.
I remember vividly early college, people were like, Jake, who's this Eldrick you keep talking about? I'm like, well, his friends call him Tiger. And they're like, okay, well then, you know, is he any good? And I'm like, just watch. And at first, people kind of laughed at me. They're like, I'm not really familiar with him. Is that the little kid that was on Carson? I'm like, yeah, but I mean, just watch the way that – and listen, I am, if nothing else. I mean, I can see the swings. I know the approach, the footing.
Sure.
Club face,
mm-hmm.
grip. I'm down with all of it, right?
Yep.
Yes, somebody just texted me. Santiago's 2-under through 10 holes. Think I don't know that? He just texted me.
Santiago did?
Yes, of course. Took a second to translate it, but I figured out what it meant. You know what I mean?
Trying to see if you can still...
Dos Andro? I know what that means.
If you want to get in on the action with Jake, he is plus 150,000.
Yeah, he's plus 250,000 yesterday.
Sports book. I know, right. But it's not too late to join
in. Get in now.
$5 to win $7,500 is what you're looking at right now. If you want to get in on...
Okay, what I'm saying is, do you understand the power of this program? I let everybody know about him yesterday, and we shaved $100,000 right off the – I mean, you know what I mean? I was already in, fortunately, right?
Yeah.
It's like insider trading.
You got him on the ground floor.
It is. It's like insider trading. I'm telling you, people, they said he was at plus 250,000 yesterday, right? And then they're like, you know, actually, that guy, the Nostradamus of radio in Indianapolis, yep. is saying, keep an eye out. And look where he is.
You don't think it has anything to do with his positioning at this point, how he's lurking? You don't think that has something to do with it?
No.
No.
That's just a confidence builder from the text I sent him. I'm telling you.
When he gets it done, are you going to get some, like, De La Fuente gear? Are you going to be on the ground floor with
get
that
it.
As well? Well, I assume if you already had it, you would be wearing it unless it's in the mail.
No. We have an understanding.
Ah, okay.
I don't want to put undue pressure on him, right?
Outside of whatever this is.
No. He knows about this. We talked about that.
So there's levels of the pressure he's going to take outside of the rigors of Augusta.
How about this? He already has an eagle. He has an eagle and a birdie. Right?
Just collecting them left and right.
All the more reason that Santiago de la Fuente is an American hero. Eagle, right? That's all you need to know. Now, he has a bogey also, but that's okay. But he eagled 8. Get back right back in the mix. I'd like a shirt. Here's what I need.
A shirt. Can he be the pride of American golf if he is of Mexican heritage?
Yes.
Like, I just want to make sure, like,
of
we're
course.
Robbing a Mexican.
It's the American dream.
But we're robbing a Mexican hero. Like, we're robbing that country.
You're robbing Mexico of their hero? We're just borrowing it.
Just borrowing, okay.
Yeah. Here's the thing. I'm going to get a shirt on the front, Nostradamus is my homie, okay?
Santiago is my friend on the back.
And yes, and on the back, Santiago, that's it, right?
My compadre.
Santiago's my compadre. Anyway.
I really hope he's in the mix on Sunday. I know you know he's going to be in the mix on Sunday, but I really hope he's in
I'm
the mix
telling
on
you
Sunday.
Right now, if he's in the mix heading down the home stretch, I'm going to have to turn off my phone, right? I mean, let's be real. I mean, Indiana went up 7-0 on Michigan, and I had like 84 text messages. and I'm like, no.
Which were for me and Eddie, at least.
And I'm like, no, I'm telling you guys, it's going to happen. And then, for some reason, Indiana didn't get the memo. Everybody else believed. I got everybody believing except for Indiana. That was their problem. And now, Kurt Cignetti, this guy is, he's not afraid to get in there and ruffle things up. And let me tell you something.
He gets memos.
Cignetti, at this point, and I think he will, don't get me wrong, but like, I'd like to know from an Indiana football fan standpoint, are we reaching the area where Kurt Cignetti better start backing it up? Because I understand confidence, but like it's, and I kind of enjoy it, and I understand it, and I respect it, right? But, you know, there's a little bit of, I get the fact that you are trying to completely, this is the one thing that I think would be challenging. When you go into a new coaching job, and you start things out by kind of by saying, like, it's a new sheriff in town. There's a new attitude, new demeanor, etc. Okay? And when you do that, that's all well and good. But when you start kind of disparaging the way things were before, it's one thing to say, like, we're going to do things differently here. But when you start kind of throwing under the bus of, like, yeah, you know, we got some guys that are going to find out that the way they were doing things isn't going to work anymore. And this isn't, you know, basically this isn't your dad's old Indiana football. It's still the place that you decided to come coach. And I think there's a very fine line of being aware of and establishing your own footing, but not totally disrespecting and disparaging those that came before you. And I think he's starting to tiptoe over it.
The way he talks about Google me, tongue-in-cheek comments to the media. And look, I love it, right? Like, I right now I love it because there's no games that have been played, and it's nice to have that level of confidence and bravado about a program that, you know, hasn't really ever had it in my lifetime, certainly. But to look at the instant success that he's had at each stop, I'm not going to go as far as to hold him, and maybe I should. Maybe this is my fault. I'm not going to hold him to his tongue-in-cheek comments, or maybe they were dead serious comments given his dedication to his craft. I'm not going to hold him to his comments at, you know, media day for the Big Ten Championship saying that we're going to be back here next year when referring to the Hoosiers. I'm not going to hold him to that to think that they're going to be in the Big Ten Championship game next year. But I think getting to a bowl game or winning a bowl game next year would be the perceived standard at minimum that appears to be being set by the leader of the program. Would you agree with that? That the vibes that he is giving off is we're going to win and we're going to win quick?
Yeah, there's no doubt that's what he's giving off, right? But I think the – and look, I get it. I get that it's probably what's needed. But what I'm saying is I think Kurt Cignetti at this point is starting to tiptoe over. There's a difference between we're going to win and we're going to win because it's me. And it's starting to look a little bit like the latter. It's very early. But he's just put himself in position to, he better back it up.
Yeah.
This from Eddie White, by the way. You talking about golf, talking to me. Jake, you talking about golf is like me talking about metaphysics. I didn't know that Eddie was a scientist. Please change the subject. A live golfer, now see, he has a typo here. A live golfer will win the Masters. And I understand, I mean, Eddie's old, so it's harder sometimes to see the little buttons on the keyboard. He meant to say a lit, because that's what the kids say about Santiago de la Fuente.
Ah, he forgot the T.
Yeah, he's lit.
In there. That happens. It's okay.
Santiago de la Fuente, I mean, that dude's lit, man. I'm telling you. He understands the course. He knows it's a longer course. But he's fine. 2 under. Already has an eagle. He's good. He's already, I mean, after today, he's 4th of the way there, right? Didn't Will Haskett say he won't make the cut?
Will Haskett, I don't know if he went that far, but I think he flat out told you he's an amateur. He's not going to win the Masters. Augusta's too complex.
I'm just saying. I recall vividly 1991, Phi Delta Theta House, University of Kansas, first week that I arrived at school. Everybody's watching the PGA, and it's at Crooked Stick, and I was like homesick as hell because I'm like, Crooked Stick's like where I'm from, whatever else, and nobody'd heard of this guy. Nobody heard of the guy, the fat guy with the mullet from Arkansas. Nobody knew. And they're like, who's this guy? And Nostradamus probably knew. John Daly, they're like, you know, he hits the heck out of the ball. And I'm sure people were like, well, I mean, he didn't have a chance. Well, you saw what happened, right?
I don't want to fully pivot from Augusta because I know we'll follow it throughout the day. But with the Mavericks beating Miami last night, it puts the Pacers in position to just need one more win to effectively stave off the play-in. Now, this is weird, and we've talked about this with John multiple times before we do the handoff to the Rival JMV every day, and you've heard him talk about it, and Jake, you've mentioned it as well numerous times over the years that, like, there was a stretch of time in Indiana sports, maybe it's still going on to some extent, where I believe you coined the phrase, you know, vat of suck was around programs and
that's
franchises.
Right.
Are you at all a little surprised like me that everything is falling into place for this to be like as perfect a close to a regular season as you could hope for the Pacers?
It is strong. They are finishing strong. No question. A little different than what Santiago is finishing today because
sure,
he just bogeyed. Now 1 under. I agree with what Bob said. Not only is Indiana playing really well, not only are they starting to kind of get their pace. I think what happened, Jimmy, quite frankly, is that when they got Siakam, it just it was for sure kind of like a an oil coagulation amongst the engine, right? It all of a sudden things sputtered for a little bit, and they had to figure out how to work around that.
Well, and then you got two flat tires as well on potholes because you trade Buddy Hield, and then correct. I feel like also on the fly, this lineup had to adjust to the loss of Benedict Mathurin. Like look, that took some time too.
As I'd mentioned at the time that it happened, Buddy Hield, the thing about Buddy Hield is he is constantly moving on the floor in the half court. And as a result of that, because Buddy Hield is a quick-release three-point shooter, and he's on the left wing, and then all of a sudden he makes a cut, now he's on the right wing, and then he's down on the baseline, and he's back up again. I mean, he is constantly moving. And that kept defenses constantly having to shift, which created open spaces long enough for Halliburton to do a step-back three. And now that Siakam is essentially, and he's not the replacement for Buddy Hield, but in terms of personnel standpoint, with Siakam, the ball goes into the low block, and things slow down a little bit, and that allows defenses to be more honest in the way that they were guarding Halliburton. And it has taken Halliburton time, as it has the others on the floor, to figure out how to play with that, because Siakam, when he gets the ball, is, in fact, no question about it, a get-out-of-the-way offensive-level player. When the shot clock's running down and you need a shot, Siakam's going to be able on his own to get that for himself. But it does come at the cost of the fluidity of their offense. And they had to relearn, well, or actually learn, because they hadn't had Siakam before. They had to learn how to make up for that to some extent. And part of how they did that, Jimmy, was they have clamped down defensively, number one. And then number two, Halliburton, I think, was just figuring out where the lanes are now open. And his shot has come back to him. And I think now there's enough body of work to say that we can definitively tell that he is, in fact, out of his slump. And that there was a time where you wondered if what we saw in late November, early to mid-December, Tyrese Halliburton wasn't the anomaly, and that what we've seen 6 weeks ago was the norm. I think now we can definitively say that the anomaly was the slump, and hopefully, you know, the step-back three guy is the norm, right?
And I also think it did take time as well. We talk about maybe not as much culture, but continuity within a locker room, within a lineup, within a rotation. And that's just a lot of trauma changes, some good, some bad, to a group that was clicking on a lot of cylinders. Like you mentioned, you bring in Siakam, you trade away Buddy Hield, and then you've only been without Benedict Mathurin for a little over a month now. And so a lot of different roles, especially that second unit, have had to re-identify themselves for where are these holes now going to be plugged. T.J. McConnell's done a great job off of the bench. At spurts, Obi Toppin has been great off of the bench. They've needed guys like Jairus Walker to step up every now and again. Ben Shepherd has stepped up in a role that was, you know, made available by the absence of Benedict Mathurin. And I think that it's a group that needed to overcome a lot of that, some by design, some by just the rigors of the NBA season. But now here they are with a real chance to do what I've hoped they were going to do all season, which is be not in a play-in drama, but be in a playoff series as a six or better, whether it's against Cleveland, New York, Orlando. We'll wait and see. But through all of that, I think it's a pretty big accomplishment to what you outlined earlier, Jake, which is 2 years ago, this is a group that outlined a plan that were honest and upfront with the fan base about patience going to be needed. And they took a big step forward this year by capitalizing on a window to go get a player like Pascal Siakam. And I expect them to, I think they can win a series depending on the matchup in the first round of the playoffs. But additionally, I expect that same navigation from Chad Buchanan and Kevin Pritchard this offseason, Jake, to take another step forward if need be.
Jacob, 239-1070, the guy with the cool first name. What's up, Jacob?
Hey, that's me. How are you guys doing?
No complaints. Is it still pouring down rain outside?
No, it's not that bad. I'm driving through Speedway right now, right by the track, actually, and it's just kind of sprinkling.
Okay. By the way, testing today washed out for day number two. What's on your mind, Jacob?
So I was just listening to you guys talk about the Pacers, and I just had a thought. I was just thinking about a curious lineup and kind of wanted to get your thoughts on it. I was thinking Tyrese Halliburton, Ben Shepherd, T.J. McConnell, Siakam, and Turner all on the floor at once. Like, what? I just kind of wanted to get your thoughts on that and what you think that might do. I thought that might get us more of a 3-point shot. I don't know. I just kind of wanted to see what you think.
Here's the thing with it. I don't totally hate it, but you are giving up a little bit of, well, I shouldn't say size. I mean, you are at the point. Obviously, McConnell has put himself in position where it's hard to keep him off the floor. But in terms of in situational rotation, I don't think it's a terrible lineup, but I'm a big believer that Nesmith needs to be on the floor for defensive purposes.
I'm with you, and I fear that you got the second
And I know that
unit.
Shepard, it does an okay job, sure. but I don't know that he has the ability to get his own shot like Nesmith.
The larger concern for me of all, and I agree with you on that too, but to add on to it, I think you got the second unit by taking McConnell out of that. You look at every metric of why that lineup does well, it's because McConnell's leading the charge there.
Yeah, that's fair.
And also, he's not the 3-point shooter that people think he is. By putting him on the floor with that lineup, it doesn't, like, that doesn't help with floor spacing. He creates his own space, but it doesn't do it in the way that I think people think it does.
TJ McConnell shooting a three.
It's quite an
act. It's like watching Charles Barkley tee off, right?
Yes.
Like, I mean, yeah, the ball's going to go where it's supposedly supposed to go, but, like, to some extent, but the form is, and, like, the you can watch the psychology of it before your very eyes.
Yeah.
By the way, Eddie Garrison on vacation, but the strange thing is he keeps texting us. Do we need to block him just to tell him to go enjoy his vacation?
Yes.
If it comes down to it, I'm willing to do that for a time.
Atticus is on board with that. Is that right?
That's right.
Why are you on board with blocking Eddie?
Well, he won't leave the three of us alone. Go enjoy Seattle.
He's in Seattle, which is – have you been to Seattle, Jimmy?
I've not been to Seattle, no.
Beautiful. I think that's the first time he's been there. Nathaniel, and for those that are unfamiliar, Nathaniel's last name is Finch. Thus, I call him Atticus. Have you been to Seattle?
Have not.
Beautiful.
What's the furthest west you've been?
Vegas.
All right. You? California.
Hawaii.
Nice.
I've been to all 50. So now Hawaii is one of the few places that I will say that look like the postcard. You know, you go
you've
to a lot
that
of places.
Before. Yeah.
It's unbelievable. It really is amazing. I mean, the entire time you're in Hawaii, you're like, I can't believe I'm in the United States. It's pretty cool. It's a little unnerving when you're flying there because the entire time you realize we're over water, and if something goes wrong, there's no emergency landing here, right?
I mean, I
unless Soli's flying the plane.
I always have one thought about that anytime I go overseas. Like when I was going to London, I had the same thought. It's like, well, this is like seven
totally.
Hours just over
correct
the ocean.
That makes you realize also how big the ocean is, right?
Yes.
It is cool though when you go to Europe in particular now, and they have the little map of where you're flying, and it like. You think that, like, you leave New York and you just go straight across, right? Well, you don't. You arc it, whatever else, even though the whole thing's flat. But when we came back from France, it was in the daytime. So it was cool to look out the window, and you're like, oh, my gosh, that's Greenland. Like, that's Iceland.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you know, you're looking at in the coast. And I mean, it's fun. But to Hawaii, you leave – I think we flew out of San Francisco. And, I mean, you're over water for 6 straight hours. There's no land at all. One little island maybe. Gilligan's on it, for what it's worth.
There you go.
Tony East going to join us. We'll talk a little more Pacers with him at bottom of the hour. But draft upcoming, and we will let you know what we have planned for that and what we think the Colts might do. We'll do it in just a couple.
Heat and cool places where ductwork won't fit using Mitsubishi Electric.
simply says, hey, little pressure here, chill out. He must have, I think, although he did par 12, so that's good. Santiago's still hanging around.
Can I ask you a question?
One under, yep.
So,
he's on my phone as SDLF, if that's what you're wondering.
That was not where I was going with that, but they have on Masters.com and on the Masters app, from what I've heard, they have featured groups they'll show throughout Augusta. And I was reading the featured groups today. Why is Santiago not in the featured groups? Does Augusta not know? Like, I don't understand. Did no one notify them?
No, it's a good question. They had, and thank you for asking because I asked them this. In the feature groups, they actually do, they track along the player based on the, you know, using their phone, GPS and that kind of thing. Yeah. He's a Motorola guy. And it's sponsored by Apple.
There you go.
Which is tough also when some of the things he's texting me, I'm like, yeah, I can't see the video. But he did say, he's like, hey, things are going well, but you started talking me up a little bit and I just, it got in my head. And he's usually pretty focused. That's what I like about him. But he just bogeyed. But he's still just one under. So he's doing well. Now, Ryan Fox is off to a pretty good start. He's 5 under through 8. But, you know, again, it doesn't last. I mean, it's very early.
Especially when you see, you know, De La Fuente lurking four or five shots back.
For sure.
Well, that's Saturday.
No, that's not
Sunday.
Uncommon. I mean, that's not uncommon. When you know, and listen, here's the other thing. Okay, Joaquin Niemann, really good golfer, right? Chilean, correct?
Yep.
It comes down to it. You know, that magic of Sunday at the Masters. Family get-togethers, and you're watching on TV, and Nance is whispering, hello, friends. And you know, the music's playing, but you feel the suspense. Joaquin Niemann is going to be very torn because he's native of Chile, right? And then he realizes that he's got a chance to see Santiago win. And so he's like, I don't know if I want to – I might just let this guy roll with it.
Will Haskett, who we had on the show yesterday, you can get that listen on the Podcast Center or wherever you get your podcast by searching Query & Company. Podcast Center, of course, on 107.5thefan.com. Hideki Matsuyama, former master champion in his own right, even through 4, tied for 18th. If, let's say that something happens, fate intervenes, you misread the stars, and Santiago de la Fuente does not win the Masters, but he does beat out Will Haskett's pick in Matsuyama. Is that still worth a text to Will? Or maybe a follow-up conversation with him, talking about how about that amateur for taking out a Masters champion, even if he comes up short?
Listen.
All right. I withdraw the question, Your Honor. Never
lot of,
mind.
A lot of golf to play here.
I disregard.
A lot of golf to play, okay?
Yeah, Tiger hasn't teed off yet. 354.
Come on. What are we doing? Are we just doing everything stepping back in time here?
Okay.
I mean, are we going to listen to Nickelback?
Are you going to say if we could turn back time, but that's fine. I guess we could go Nickelback.
Party like it's 2002.
I'll look at some photographs of Tiger Woods. It's cool. No problem.
By the way, we're going to party like it's October 11th. That's at Everwise Amphitheater at White River State Park. There is nothing better on an early autumn evening than being out at White River State Park listening to live music. Country Variation, for example, Justin Moore, Randy Houser, Austin Michael, all going to be there on October the 11th. Everwise Amphitheater at White River State Park. And you're saying to yourself, Jake, that's great. I'd love to go, but I don't have tickets. Well, we do. And we will allow you, and right now, in honor of our man Santiago, who is just, what is he, one under?
Yes.
Well, we can't go call her one. That's just a word. 239-1070 is the telephone number. We'll let Nathaniel decide at 239-1070 in terms of the tickets that we're giving away for October 11th at White River State Park
he
in
should
the
do
amphitheater.
It. He should do it on what? How many strokes he thinks that Santiago de la Fuente is going to win the Masters by. That should
that's
be your caller
great,
number.
That's a good call
yeah,
there.
I agree.
Caller number five.
You think he's going to win by 5
That's
strokes?
Right.
I like that. I like that. All right, caller number 5, you're on your way. Let's talk next.
The Ride with JMV.
Of course he's not going to.
the NFL, the 365, 24/7 dominant sport in this country. And they're right, because you can blink twice and get enamored in March Madness with having free agency bookending that. And then once you've taken two blinks, you realize it's just 2 weeks from the NFL draft. In Detroit this year, April 25th through the 27th, your Indianapolis Colts with the 15th pick.
How many are going to be there at that draft?
How many, like, fans in attendance?
Yep.
Is there a joke that I'm missing here?
Well, I mean, you know, this is my thing, right?
Sure.
When they say that, like, for Kansas City, didn't they say there were 600,000 people at the draft?
Yeah, something like that, yes.
You've been to Kansas City, right?
I have.
The area where the draft was, what's it hold, 40, 50,000?
Yeah, probably.
Okay. Anyway, go ahead.
The number here is at least 300,000 people.
Ooh.
For Detroit?
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you think we'll see it? Do you think north of that? Think they'll stack to the...
I'm just going to do this once, and then I'm going to get off my soapbox, and I won't do it again until... Okay. I have no dispute whatsoever that the NFL is a massive product and the 800-pound gorilla within the American sports landscape. I get that. I don't understand why they need to inflate numbers like that. Everybody knows they're the dominant one, right? So why do they have to inflate it? 300,000 people. This is what I always say. We have tangible visual evidence in the city of Indianapolis, Indiana, that if you are to take people side by side, elbow to elbow, shoulder to shoulder, 125 deep, that 325,000 people is 2.5 miles around. But the NFL draft manages to get them all in 6 square blocks.
Now, do you ever worry about the fact that there is, let's just say, some poor old gentleman, let's call him Steve, whose job is to just eyeball this total, and now you're putting into question his vision there by saying he's counting doubles or triples?
I'd like Steve to eyeball my tax return and then tell me how much I'm getting back, right?
We jokes aside, though, and number inflation aside, I do appreciate what the NFL has tried to do the last however many years this is now, what, 5, 6, maybe I'm jumping a couple there, of this being a traveling circus.
Okay.
I like what they've done with the draft.
I don't disagree with that, but here's what I think the NFL, and it's a much, much, much longer process, okay? But hear me out. NASCAR. NASCAR was a regionalized sport in the 70s and 80s. It was a sport whose epicenter was the Daytona 500, and it ran at places like Rockingham and Darlington and you know, along the East Coast, but primarily in the Southeast. And then it got super popular in the mid-90s, largely, but certainly helped by going to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, which was its first indoctrination into going to non-traditional NASCAR tracks. And when it did so, NASCAR then was like, you know what? We're going to start going to places that aren't typical NASCAR markets. And they started putting races at Chicago Speedway and Las Vegas and California. And in doing so, doing it instead of Rockingham and Darlington for a second race and places like that. And it was massive. It was huge. It was like a brush fire. But eventually they oversaturated themselves, and many of the people that fell in love with it in those markets started moving on to a different fad, swing dancing or martinis or cigars or whatever the new fad was, and fewer of them started going to those racetracks. And then all of a sudden, NASCAR's like, well, we'll go back to our traditional tracks. And people were like, no, we moved on also. It got so big that it got a little bit greedy in its growth. Now, the NFL for years, and I don't dispute that it's the 800-pound gorilla, but the NFL for years, its growth came in the fact that it was appointment viewing, because it was games on Sunday and Monday night. And the Monday night game was unbelievable because the whole world was watching, and that was the only game on. Now the NFL is doing, the combine is round-the-clock coverage. The draft is round-the-clock coverage. And now games, they're now moving games to Brazil on Friday. Games on Thursday Night Football. Then later in the year, you get Saturday. It is starting to stretch itself to the point where the diehard NFL fan, which I realize is a 15 times the number of any other sport, But the diehard NFL fan isn't going to go anywhere. I get that. But it is starting to compromise its product because the uniqueness of it is it starts to dissolve a little bit. There were a handful of years ago, I remember Pete the Planner sending a tweet one time that just said, I don't know what it is, but for the first time in my life, I find myself caring less about the NFL. And I know that people want to say, like, it was the woke nature of it, and it was taking a knee, and it was Colin Kaepernick. Those things certainly factored for some people, I realize. But a big part of it was there, for the first time ever, and every other sport has had it. This is not unique to the NFL. It's not an indictment on the NFL. It's a natural thing that there becomes a fatigue factor that happens with anything that becomes oversaturated. And the NFL, without question, has the largest, like, way out in front of everybody gap on that ever happening. But these sorts of things over the course of time, Jimmy, I do think start to factor into a potential fatigue factor from people. And the draft is, I don't disagree with you that it is, I mean, I know people love to go and watch it and get together with your buddies and it's fun to watch the reaction of people in the first round, etc. But I can see where already I would say that the number of people going to the draft live and all of that, there is no doubt that it was smaller in Kansas City than it was the year before when it was in, like, Nashville, I think it was. And that was maybe a little bit smaller than when it had been in – they should just do everything in Vegas, truth be told, right?
Yeah.
But so what I'm getting at is I'm not trying to be old man yelling at clouds at all. I'm just saying there is – the NFL is if there is a sports entity that could be immune to fan fatigue, it would be the NFL. But the NFL is doing its best to test that theory. That's all I'm saying.
I feel like there's a couple separate conversations there, but they all go to your larger point about potentially oversaturating the market and turning viewers off that way. And I don't necessarily fully disagree with that premise, but, like, I agree with where you're coming from on the thoughts of, okay, they want to get football eventually on every day of the week. And I feel like the Thursday night matchups are already bad enough most of the time that that's not a core premise that's going to translate well. Like, I think that expanding to more games and more days of the week ultimately is what could impact your bottom line more than rotating the draft year by year. But I understand you're talking about the totality of all of these actions combined. Now, it should be noted, and I had to look this up. I was unaware that it was this good last year, but they had 17.9 million viewers on average for regular season games, tied for the second highest since they've tracked it since 95. So that's, I mean, a big boom for the NFL just on last year alone. There have been, in the last 10, 15 years, you're right, areas of decline and dips for a lot of different factors. And I'm right there with you. I don't think they should expand to more days for more games. However, in terms of these little events, and I guess I guard the combine because it's an Indianapolis staple, but the idea of having events like the draft that move around, that let these cities that maybe might not ever host a Super Bowl, like, I don't know that Nashville's ever going to host a Super Bowl unless they build a new stadium, right? But to be able to have other ways to promote those organizations at a regional level and give them the national platform to do it, I like that with what they're doing with the draft because I feel like it gives more exposure to markets. It's also, by the way, 10 years since they've been, or 9 years since they've been in New York, or since they've left New York. They were in Chicago in 15. And in 16, and then they did their rotator of, okay, let's go to Nashville, let's go to Vegas, let's go to Kansas City. I think that the idea of taking a property like the draft and giving exposure to markets at a further level and making it all about them is cool.
So let me ask you this. If they put the NFL draft at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, would every seat be filled?
Based on Steve's count, yes. And the infield would be filled.
But realistically... Would every seat plus the infield? Yeah, you're right. Every seat plus the infield be filled?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. JR, 239-1070.
But you've talked about it. Like, you've talked about different ways the city could with, like...
No, I get it.
Like an Indy car.
I'm not poo-pooing it at all. I'm just saying.
Drive the pick out?
That was your
idea, wasn't it?
Yeah, I'm just
drive
saying.
Drive the pick out on an Indy car?
Can you imagine if they do a whole lap? Before
it'd be awesome.
JR, what's up?
Hey, hey, Jake, how are you?
I'm all right.
Listen, you know, in comparison, I work in the retail industry. I'm a member of the company director of import export.
I like that. You're at Mandalay.
Yeah, for sure. So in 95, almost 30 years ago, there were 2,000 Walmart stores in the U.S. and 2,500 Kmart stores. Currently, obviously, there are two remaining Kmart stores now, and 4,700 Walmart stores. So if you don't change, you will fail.
So are you saying to the NFL's point? So you're saying the NFL, they are they're Walmart in this equation, is what you're saying, or are you saying they could fall victim to it?
Well, if you remember, I mean, I'm about the same age as you are, Jake. I mean, I know you remember going to Kmart and the blue light specials.
Of course.
And the subs. Yeah. Big deal, right? And Walmart was just slowly gaining traffic. And, you know, I have to get too retail on you, but basically Kmart operated under a high-low system where everybody knew you could go in and a gallon of paint or whatever, a pair of underwear was $10, and it was always on sale for $5. Walmart comes along and says, you know, we're going to sell our underwear for $4.50 every day. I mean, it's no different than, you know, like I kind of compare this to ESPN, unfortunately, you know, lived and died, said every day that I was in college watching SportsCenter, you know, repeat ever over and over and over again. You know, my boy who's 14 doesn't want anything to do with SportsCenter. He would rather watch it on his phone really quick and move on, you know. So it's like, just because the NFL is the 8,000-pound gorilla in the room right now doesn't mean that it's going to stand on its own feet for a long time.
No, that's fair.
What's going on?
But to their point, I guess maybe mixing it around, JR, maybe that's what they are doing, right? Maybe by extending and going to playing Brazil on a Friday, I mean, maybe that's their variation of staying current as opposed to getting comfortable, if that makes sense.
Yeah, fair enough. I mean, I guess my overall point is, you know,
let me ask you this, JR. So you are, if you don't mind me asking, you're how old?
53.
Okay. Do you find your level of interest in all things NFL at the age of 53 more or less than it was when you were 40?
Gosh, that's a tough question to answer. I still enjoy going, but I like to watch it through the eyes of my son. Right? When I was 40, you know, it was a different type of experience for me. Right? You know, it was a whole day.
Do you watch? Okay. Do you watch the draft?
I do actually. I would say yes.
Are you a Colts fan?
Absolutely. Okay. Season ticket holder since 96.
Okay. Would you watch on Thursday night if it's the Vikings and Browns? What are the odds you're watching?
Not so good.
Yeah. See, that's my point being, JR, if you remember when, and I know I'm on the way back and I'm the old guy here, but when the Colts played the Denver Broncos in 88 on Monday Night Football on Halloween night, or 87 or whatever it was, the whole excitement of it was you knew, or at least you felt like the entire country was watching because it was the only game on that was not a Sunday game.
100%.
And that Thursday night game between the Vikings and Browns, part of the reason why you went, I don't know that I'm watching, is because you know if you miss it, no big deal. There's going to be football again within 4 days or three days or 2 days or, you know, whatever it might be.
And the way I consume it is different now, too. I mean, I know that I can watch that at any given point.
Correct. And you could also, if Deshaun Watson rattles off a 92-yard scramble touchdown, you don't have to be watching it live because you can watch it on your phone on X or Facebook or whatever 2 minutes later. I mean, that's the other thing that comes into play for sure.
100%. And I guess when I reference the way I watch and my fandom to the NFL compared to my son, who's 14, 15 years old now, you know, he's more player-focused, right? Like he's obviously a Colts fan because he'd have to move out if he wasn't. But you know, it's, you know, he tracks players and their results, and I
well, that's the fantasy effect, right? And the fantasy effect absolutely not only grew the fan base, appreciate it, JR, but fantasy also got like women involved. But again, that's another one where I think fantasy football was massive at one time. I think now there are people that there are probably fewer people that play it, right, than there were 10 years ago.
Well, there's the other 800-pound gorilla that the NFL and other sports leagues have gotten into bed with over the last 5 years. I know it very well.
But that's every league, though.
No, I know, but I mean, like, it is as vital to the NFL as it is to any league. Like, why we talk about what would happen if you try to put...
You're talking about gambling, obviously.
Right, I'm talking about sports gambling.
Right.
If you're, like, this is sad, and I get it. Like, I might put 5, 10, 15, maybe 20 bucks on any given game from my perspective. I know people that put much more, and whatever, that's their prerogative. 1-800 night with it, as Jake often sends my way. But, like, that's how you make a – from my vantage point, if it's a, you know, a cruddy game, it's Vikings-Browns, okay, I'll put 10 bucks on the over for Deshaun Watson passing yards, you know, and you have something to root for there. Or to the fantasy point, maybe you have I don't know, Kirk Cousins doesn't work anymore, so I'll use Deshaun Watson again. Maybe you have Deshaun Watson as a quarterback of your fantasy team, and so you have a reason to maybe stick around and watch now, versus if you eliminate those things, or if you go back in time 20 years, I guess you can't go full 20. Let's go 18. Let's go to 06 when Thursday Night Football first started. It was more of a new kind of niche thing, and then they've added Thursday, and it's become socially accepted, and I can get on board with that. Jake, I think a lot of people can get on board with Monday, Thursday, Sunday. Okay, that's fine. But I'm with you on the dates thing. The further Correct. You try to do this Tuesday, it's like, I just need a day.
You know,
like,
the other thing?
Give me a day off before we jump
Correct.
Back into this thing.
You're right. And here's the other thing, Jimmy, that where I think the NFL has to be careful, okay? And I realize we segued into a kind of a different conversation, but I think it's a good one. I think the NFL, college football did this, and it rubbed people the wrong way. The NFL playing on Friday nights needs to be careful.
Yes, totally agree. Totally agree.
And I'll tell you why.
Yep.
What states do you think of when you think of football?
Yeah.
What's the first state that comes to mind?
Texas.
When you think of high school football in Texas, what's the term we use for that?
Friday Night Lights.
There is a purity of high school sports that people still hold on to and still love. And it's sacred to a lot of people. High school athletics are sacred to a lot of people, especially high school football. I have said before on numerous occasions, I worked at Channel 6 in local television sports in different capacities. I don't know, 15 years, 10 years, whatever. I really don't miss it. But the one thing that I miss was I loved on Friday nights going and covering high school football. I loved it. Standing on the sidelines, going and getting a couple highlights, getting in the truck, driving to the next location, doing two nights in one game, or two games in one night, rushing back to the station at 10:45 and putting together a package, that's what we call a story, that aired at 11:20 for Friday Night Football. I loved it. It was the pure of sport. And people hold that across the country, Ohio, Indiana, Florida, Texas. That's held in a very high regard. When I went to the University of Kansas, guys that I went to school with that lived within driving distance of Lawrence would go home on Friday nights to go back to watch their high school football team play. Okay? And you kind of do that for a year or two in college, and, you know, stand on the sidelines. But and then your kids get into it. But I think that the NFL has a lot of areas where it displays an arrogance, where it gets a pass. But if it starts interfering with what people see as a threat to the attendance of high school games and taking away Friday night from high school kids, I think it's a dangerous precedent. I know that that sounds ridiculous, but it's the one area that I think people hold very highly.
Right, and it's added by the fact that growing up, you know, I was well documented, but just from my perspective, I went to Roncalli High School. Still, for that very reason, broadcast games for them throughout all sports, but nothing like a Friday night at Bob Tully Field over there at Roncalli. But you go high school football on a Friday night. For me, it was Notre Dame football on Saturday and the Chiefs on Sunday. And those were always defined days. You go high school, college, professional. That's your weekend. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. There was never any interlocking of, okay, we're going to have NFL football on a Saturday, or you're going to have, like you mentioned, a significant college football matchup on a Friday. It was understood that the football pyramid was high school, college, pros. And I'm with you. I think it's a very dangerous game if you're right. The NFL and you start trying to undercut the two below you, especially Friday night, because Texas, Ohio, Indiana to an extent too, like, yeah, that matters. I know we're the basketball
totally.
State, but there are
what
powerful states.
What do NFL players do on their bye week if they're not going to Aruba.
They go to their high school game.
Correct. They go back to their high school game. On a Friday night, right?
Yep.
There are very few areas where the NFL can, like, overstep into a more religious area of sport of football. But Friday night's one of them, yeah. I'm telling you.
Yeah.
And but I just look at, and I know it's one game, but one game. Thursday night football, fine. Like, in the initial time that Thursday night football came on, I literally felt like it was the NFL's participation trophy. Because they came up with Thursday Night Football on the NFL Network because they told every franchise, like, if we're going to start our own network, everybody's going to get their own game. And then they realized, well, all of the main games, we want to be on the networks that are paying us billions of dollars. So we've got to somehow find a place where we can put the Cardinals-Browns game.
Yeah.
I mean, those first the first years of Thursday Night Football on
I remember when because the Chiefs were not great at the time. But as a kid, it's like, oh, like, from the kid's perspective, that was neat to see my team on a national block. I'm sure if I was older at the time, I would have realized what's actually happening, which is they need to keep the big games, like you mentioned, for the top dogs, and they're just throwing a bone here for Thursday Night Football. But that was neat. Now it's evolved, too, as I've gotten older, and as I think other fans have gotten older, oftentimes we see Al Michaels complain. Al Michaels, of all people. The face
you remember,
of the sport.
Wasn't it the Broncos Colts? Yes. And he's like, this is going to be the end of me, right?
And that's more often than not the type of matchup that you get on Thursday nights. But that, I think, should have been and should be a warning sign for the NFL to look at how hard it is to find quality matchups on Thursday. And now you want to try to spread it further over other days of the week? I don't know. But if they put a pause to that and they continue the engagements of what we started about, which is having the draft at different places. And by the way, the more I read about it, the more I think that 300,000 number has to be total people over the event.
So they've changed, they've moved the goalpost.
Correct.
Because originally, the first year that they did it, what was the first year where they did the traveling? Was it Nashville?
They did Chicago twice, but I don't know if that was
Nashville's
as big
the one.
Nashville was the signature one.
And they said there were a million people.
Something like that, yes.
And then it was like, well, no, we met a million over 3 days. And I'm like, well, that's still 300,000 per day. Now it's like, no, we mean 300,000 for the 3 days. Well, is that uniques? Are you telling me there's different people every day?
I think it's just totality, right?
Well, but what I'm saying is, so you're counting the same guy three times.
Correct, yes.
Now, I will admit this. If you want to go to the draft for the first round, fine. If you are somebody that is standing outside on a pavement for the seventh round pick.
And you're not related to the picks.
And you're booing because they didn't take the Texas A&M backup long snapper that you were hoping for. Then like somewhere there are people, your friends are laughing at you, right?
One other nugget to the scheduling conversation. This is from Griff on the YouTube chat. Shout out to the break room. And I always forget about this until it actually happens. Red zone Sundays matter to me and a lot of people because the red zone channel shows you nothing but nonstop adrenaline action throughout an entire Sunday. And oftentimes the more you spread out games, and this is Griff's point, you have a lame red zone
day. Good point.
You only have four games rotating through.
Right.
Yeah.
That's kind of like the NCAA tournament. The opening day of the NCAA tournament is the best because you're like, oh my gosh, I'd forgotten how many games
and
there
this
are.
One, and this
and then
one,
the
and
next
this
weekend,
one.
You're like, wait a minute, isn't there another game? Like, no, wait, there's only eight games
and
today.
And practical jokers are back on True TV right now? I don't understand. They had TCU Northwestern the other day.
You're exactly right. I did. I one of the games, I was like, well, maybe it's on True, you know, because you're joking. And I'm like, wait a minute, why am I watching a guy, like, playing a prank on a portalette? What's going on here? I wanted to see Samford. Tony E's going to join us next.
Hi, it's Bob from Royal Spa. Soaking in a hot tub full of Epsom.
Now, we have a bit of an issue here, Jimmy, just so you know.
On the course or in the studio?
Just a hiccup.
Okay.
For Santiago, just a hiccup.
Uh-oh.
Santiago de la Fuente now one over. He bogeyed the last two holes. Just texted me, said his grip. Grip was a little off because he started sweating a little bit. And I said, well, why? And he said, because you keep talking about me. So I'm grooming him, right? Building characters, what we're doing. But Santiago de la Fuente, and when it happens, like I said, I didn't say necessarily this year, but when he becomes a phenomenon and a thing, then people are going to be like, you know what? I first heard about that on that radio program with that guy that's Nostradamus' homie. Joining us now, and I'm sure thrilled to be doing so based on that, regular guest of the program. Of course, you can read his work in a variety of different places, Forbes being one of them, SI being another, Tony East joining us, X and Twitter, where he is breaking down what happens for the Pacers down the home stretch. There are two games left. They are in Cleveland tomorrow night. They are home to close things out against Atlanta, and an Atlanta team that suddenly has some injury coming into play and has kind of locked themselves. I don't think they can go. Am I correct in this, Tony? The Atlanta Hawks, who are here to close things out for the Pacers, are locked into the play-in, but they can't get out of that. So it may be in their best interest to kind of rest some people. Is that true?
Yeah, their spot's tricky. So if the Bulls win tonight or tomorrow, the Hawks are locked into 10th no matter what. But Trae Young just coming back from injury, maybe they want to get him some reps and up to speed ahead of that 9-10 game. We'll see. But they are definitely not going to be motivated to win anymore should the Bulls win one more time before Sunday.
Tony, I asked Jake this earlier. I want to get your thoughts on it. With the Mavericks beating the Heat last night, it basically, if I am remembering, and I think you tweeted this out, that if they win tomorrow night, they're out of the play-in conversation. They're good. They're fine. They're going to be in the playoffs in some capacity. With the winning streak they've been on and everything kind of falling into place, Miami stumbling, you mentioned just a second ago Atlanta, other things just kind of locking right where they should be, is it at all jarring that really everything has gone as perfect as Pacers could have hoped for to close a season with this last push they've been on?
I'd say yes and no. I'd say I'm not surprised in that. When I ran through their schedule before the season and tried to pick out wins and losses and predict their record, you know, I had them closing the season pretty strong. Their schedule has not been particularly difficult, you know, since they got home from that West Coast swing in the middle of March. And to their credit, they have taken care of business more recently than they have at other times since the All-Star break. They finally have won three games in a row for the first time since the All-Star break. Their defensive level has been impressive the whole time. So on one hand, I'm surprised given that they haven't played anyone so talented in the stretch. On the other hand, they've been so wildly inconsistent, you know, all season and even more so since the break that I think it's 9 of 14 they've won right now. It is impressive that they've been able to do that, string it together, and, you know, have kind of a different leader a lot of the time, right? Halliburton with 30 two nights ago, McConnell a lot of the time, Siakam sometimes, even Miles Turner in a couple games against Dallas. That's what's been so fascinating to me about this is that it's just been such a team identity kind of way of doing it. That's been more surprising to me.
For those that don't know, Tony East is our guest, covers the Pacers for Sports Illustrated. For those that don't know, Tony, walk me through what is still up for grabs for the Pacers in terms of the best spot they could be in that's still on the table and how they would get to that to the worst spot they could be in at this stage with two games left.
Yeah, I could fill out the rest of my time with you guys talking about their scenarios for the rest of the season. They can still get to three, actually. It would take a lot of chaos of Knicks losses, Magic losses, Cavs losses, and the Pacers winning out. But they can get the three seed still, which to me would be, in theory, the dream. I mean, they would get to host the first round and avoid the Boston side of the bracket, which is, I think, something that a lot of people are in front of their skis talking about the Celtics. But that is, in theory, the best possible scenario. If they win out, the Pacers are guaranteed no worse than fifth because they would pass the Cavs by beating them and clinching the tiebreaker tomorrow night. They can get fourth based on a lot of the factors we just talked about, but they can also fall to eighth still. If the Heat win out and the Pacers lose out and the Magic lose out, the Pacers would be eighth. So there's still a lot of variety in where they can go. They can still be in the play-in. If the Magic, the Sixers tomorrow, they clinch a playoff spot regardless of their own results. So there's still a lot up in the air. They could still end up anywhere from 3-8, and obviously some matchups and seeds are preferable to others, but to me, they can't get it, like I said, can't get ahead of their skis and think about the matchups. To me, it's get in first, see what's in front of you on Sunday, figure it out, and then decide maybe we can try to manipulate a better matchup for ourselves.
So, Tony, here's an easy way to simplify this before we get into how they're playing, which I think is really good right now. But so just for example, I've got a buddy that wants to come in for the playoff, okay? And he says, I want to come in for the two home games of the first round of the playoffs for the Pacers, assuming that they are in a series not to play in. Whether or not they are the 5 seed or the 6 seed shifts, if I'm not mistaken, which two games they would host, right? And so
yeah, four and five would be the switch, yeah.
Yes. Well, so what I'm saying is but the safest assumption is that they're the 6 because that is the most scenarios in play would land them as the 6, correct?
That is correct, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So that's what I'm writing down. Come in as if they are the 6. The only problem is they're coming from the other side of the world. It's kind of costly.
Every website that does the odds of getting a certain seed say that 6 is most likely for the Pacers finishing, just behind all the teams they're currently behind. But given the Magic schedule, I think 5 and even 4, if they beat Cleveland, are certainly plausible, like within very realistic possibilities. But we'll learn a lot on Friday night about the Pacers' fortunes the rest of the way.
Okay. Then moving along to the way that they are playing, you obviously want to be playing your best basketball at the end of the year. Maybe their best basketball still was mid-December, but it's a different lineup than then, clearly, with Siakam and nobody healed. But for this particular group, with Pascal Siakam and with nobody healed, is this the best they have played since the acquisition?
Yes, I think so. The defense has been largely pretty good, or at least good for their standards since the start of March, but they've paired it with some really nice offensive games of late, obviously scoring 140. Going to do that. But, when you get to this point in the season, every team is kind of not well scouted, I would say, but, you just kind of understand what teams are doing and what their counters are when you cut them off. And the Pacers, who have spoken all season about what they call their random offense, when they are really clicking in that random style where it's, very hard for other teams to predict what's coming next, but the Pacers are at least aware of all the possibilities and able to gel on that end. That's when they look so good because, they can have Halliburton go off for 30 for the first time in 3 months, or have a night where Miles Turner's spacing is really important, or T.J. McConnell's, LeBron's favorite player for 2 months because he can't miss a shot inside of 6 feet. That is what's really kind of paired with their defense in the last 15 or so games that have made them. And I believe they have the second best record in the NBA across their last 10 games of any team. I think all of that clicking at the same time is the best they've played since they acquired Siakam in January.
Tony, this happens with any fan base whenever an injury occurs. So I'm going to look the other way, but I want you to talk some sense into some of Pacers fandom. With what they've been able to do, in credit to T.J. McConnell leading that second unit, I've advocated that he should be in consideration for Sixth Man of the Year. But a lot of people point to, well, look at what they've done, and they've done all this even without Benedict Mathurin. The dynamic of that conversation, where, if anything, does that change expectations for him next year? And on top of that, what was the harder element for the Pacers to adapt to? The season-ending injury to Mathurin or the trading of Buddy Hield that forced them to kind of reinvent themselves to some extent?
Yeah, to the no Mathurin part, I talked to, when you guys heard me on right after that, we talked about who would play the two more and who would step up, and we talked about McConnell, right? Like, that's what I think it seemed like the bridge has been really easy, is that he has picked up a huge ball handling role with the second unit and just not missed a beat at all. And credit to him, he's shooting 60% every game, and he's 15-6 every night, and they can hardly get him off the floor, and the Pacers bench of 5 bench guys is outscoring other team starters. No one saw that coming. I thought he'd take on more responsibility and play well, but the fact that it's required him to be at a by far career best scoring level kind of says what Mathurin gives them, right? They need that ball handling punch with the second unit. If McConnell could do this forever, he'd be thought of as a way different player. Maybe he can, but it's certainly been interesting to see that. The Bulls game that they lost in Chicago, where Chicago cut off the rim and they were pressuring the Pacers up high. Like, those kind of games are where Mathurin's really good, right? Clearly they missed him in that game. The, you know, some of the Lakers games they could have used him. The Timberwolves game they lost it. Like, it's obvious when they don't have him and they're struggling where he would help, even though there have been certain ways where, like, the bench group has clicked largely because of McConnell and his absence. I think that the adjustment without him was seamless because McConnell stepped up so much more than anything, whereas when they lost Buddy Hield, I mean, not only did they lose Buddy Hield, but 3 weeks later they lost Mathurin, who was shooting well this season. I think that was a harder adjustment for them because for the first 3-4 months of the season, they were a top 5 3-point shooting team in the league, right? And they still have a lot of those shooters, but that combined with Halliburton also, you know, going through that dip in his shooting too, they couldn't make anything from deep. They were like bottom 2 in 3-point percentage for like 10 games coming out of the break. I think that was a harder adjustment for them that they've now figured out a little bit how to mitigate and survive. But it's kind of short-term bandages that as your roster changes, you have to keep constantly figuring them out. And maybe McConnell can just be this awesome forever and that changes things. But that is sort of something, even though I thought his role would expand and he'd be important, I didn't even foresee him being this good in Mathurin's absence.
Tony, clearly Tony East is our guest. Miles Turner, I guess, technically speaking, is the Pacers' best defender because you think of his rim protection. I think Aaron Nesmith is their best on-ball defender. Who are 3 and 4? Who are the 3 and 4? Who are the 3rd and 4th best defenders? And throw anybody else in if you disagree with that order, but that you would say are their best defensive players.
Yeah, I would give Andrew Nembhard a run at number 2, actually.
That's a good call.
You know, the way he handles guards is really impressive to me, and that's just such an important role for them in terms of where it allows them to place Tyrese Haliburton. Him and Nesmith are, you know, you can go either way on both. I think both are a fine answer for the second best defender, but he's just like slowing down the opposing team's best ball handler is such an important task, and he has to do it basically every game and often stays out of foul trouble. You know, he would definitely be the 3rd guy in that conversation for me. Number 4 is where it gets tricky. Like, Siakam has not been at the level that I thought he'd be defensively.
Agreed.
He's been better of in my eyes, he's been better of late, but the first month or so was not what I expected. I think my answer for number 4 maybe is Isaiah Jackson, but I'm very high on his defense and always have been. He can keep up with perimeter players and is pretty mobile around the basket. Jalen Smith's rebounding is, of course, a valuable defensive trait. Siakam, lately, I guess with his size, could sneak into this conversation. I think Isaiah Jackson would be my pick if you put a gun to my head. But it's tough after 3.
2 that we didn't mention there, but I'm curious of your thoughts on defensively if they're guys that can really grow into that being as much their role moving forward. Ben Shepherd and Jairus Walker.
Yeah, so Shepherd, I think, has been in probably their best defensive 5-man unit this year if they had to just come up with it. Still some rookie moments, like adjusting to the game, but has defended well, fights through screens, is never out of a play. Right, McConnell's a good defender, but has size limitations on how many matchups he could take in a given game, which is why I opted to go a different direction there. Shepherd, yeah, I agree with you. He maybe should have gotten more recognition for me just then. And Jairus is interesting because early in the season, he was so gambly and so handy that he was not in this conversation at all. Like, the thing he was drafted to do, he was not ready for quite yet in the NBA, but that has sort of changed for him since, you know, his G League stints and getting more opportunities with the Pacers. I think the most recent game he played in the rotation in Chicago, his defense wasn't particularly good, but you saw him do a lot better on that road trip. He was playing almost every game. So I think he will be in that conversation for sure. He has the tools. He has the instincts. Like, every time, even when he messes up, he gets right back into play and does the right thing to get out of that situation. Now, he deserves blame for being in it, but so I think his instincts are so good that he will be in this conversation probably sooner rather than later, honestly. But I can't put either of the rookies above any of those guys I named so far.
Tony East of Sports Illustrated covers the Pacers there, as well as host of the Locked On Pacers podcast. You can get that wherever you get your podcast. Tony, the rotation for the Pacers, and I'm talking about the back half of the rotation where you're looking at just guys fighting for minutes or contribution areas there in spurts, the Doug McDermott's of that lineup. Who has the most to be gained from a situational series, whether it's against Cleveland, whether it's Orlando, New York? Who has the most to gain on the back end of the rotation, and is there still minutes to be fought for there, or will it just be a matchup-determined decision by Coach Carlisle and company?
That's a good question. I think it would be matchup-based, like, because in my head – you know, McConnell playing really good, Toppin, both of those guys playing really good right now, but also you know, they play naturally the position of the Pacers stars, right? Haliburton and Siakam in the playoffs are going to play, you know, you'd think nearly 40 minutes a night. So any matchup that allows those guys to play unique roles, I would think would be where my brain kind of naturally trends to go. You know, Obi at the five or Pascal at the five could be something fascinating for this Pacers team to explore, or TJ and Tyrese together as more often or as often as possible, all sorts of things like that. Cleveland makes that maybe a little possible because they kind of start two bigs together. New York is a little tricky for that. Orlando could be a good one for TJ McConnell because, you know, they're so big, but they're a little slower, that his pace and ball handling can kind of help them be a little bit more involved in rotation. But I think that in general, it's going to be, how can they build out from what the stars can do in a particular series? And that's so matchup-based, it's hard to say what the best situation is for the Pacers there.
Okay, Tony, to wrap things up here, I'm going to give you, with remaining games here for our listeners, okay? This might be a challenge, so my apologies. I'm going to give you a couple of games, and you tell me who the Pacers need to be rooting for, okay?
Okay.
All right. We will begin, and if it is irrelevant to Indiana, you just simply say that's irrelevant, okay?
Okay, you got it. Yep.
New York at Boston.
New York at Boston. The Pacers are rooting for the Celtics.
Okay. Orlando at Philadelphia. We're now on to Friday. Orlando at Philadelphia.
Okay, can I give two answers to this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, if the Pacers want to host the first-round series, they're rooting for the 76ers. If the Pacers want the best chance possible to make the playoffs, they're rooting for the Orlando Magic.
Okay. Obviously, the Pacers in Cleveland, they're rooting for the Pacers.
yes, yes.
Brooklyn at New York.
Yeah, they're rooting for Brooklyn. They can still, in theory, catch the Knicks because they own that tiebreaker.
Okay. Toronto at Miami.
Toronto largely irrelevant, but Toronto winning one of those two games in Miami would secure the Pacers' top seven. So Toronto.
Okay, clearly, I'm assuming Atlanta at Minnesota. You're going to go ahead and root for the non-Eastern Conference
team,
right?
Non-East team, yes.
Goes without saying. Okay, then shifting to the finale in terms of the schedule, games on Sunday. I'm looking at it here. Okay, Charlotte at Cleveland.
Probably Charlotte for the Pacers in that one. But Sunday could be crazy with tiebreakers and matchups that maybe they do want. You know, if they want to play the Cavs, maybe they do end up wanting the Cavs to win it. That one's harder to say right now.
Milwaukee at Orlando.
Yeah, again, it could be a coming down to home court versus clinching thing, but I would assume Milwaukee would be their choice in that one.
Okay, so there you go. So they're going to end up as the sixth seed, right? That's what we know?
that's possible, yes. Can I throw in a wrinkle for you?
Love a good wrinkle.
Yes. Okay. The Pacers would like to see the Raptors lose one more time, like to see the Pelicans lose all their games and the Cavs lose all their games. So their second round picks can be as good as possible, but that does not matter for making the playoffs.
Wow. Okay.
I love a good draft pick talk thrown in on a postseason
push.
You know,
I'm not going to lie to you. For 51 years old, I'm actually kind of proud of my lack of wrinkles. So, you know, if you want to throw one in from time to time, that's fine. But I have all kinds of different lotions and serums and stuff like that for that stuff. Tony, we appreciate it as always. Going to be kind of a flurry here down the stretch, but that's much better than the alternative. We've seen years recently where they're on the outside looking in, so we appreciate the conversation.
You got it. Thanks for having me, guys. Looking forward to hopefully prepping to talk about the playoffs next week.
Playoffs for sure. Where they're going to be, I don't know. I'm telling you, they're in. They're going to finish strong, man. They win tonight, Jimmy?
No. Yeah, yes. Oh, yeah. Tomorrow
night?
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
Tomorrow night?
Think they beat Cleveland. I think they close out on a nice winning streak.
They turn that corner of winning the games they're supposed to win?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. They'll take care of Atlanta on Sunday to close things out. They'll take care of Cleveland. And then at that point, what you're looking at, like the five seed potentially. So it'll be fun. They are on the doorstep of achieving everything I was bullish on them achieving back in September, which is being a six seed or better and not messing around with the play-in. There's still work to be done. It's not official yet, but that bold prediction at the time elevated to a strong take once they acquired Pascal Siakam. And give credit to Chad Buchanan and Kevin Pritchard for that acquisition, because I think it really, as you mentioned, Jake, accelerated the growth and the expectation for what they could do this year.
You know, it looks like I'm having to scroll a little further to find my guy.
Yeah, I was going to wait till the plays of the day to update you on that.
Oh, not bad. Not bad. He's through 15. Still just one over.
Previously, the $5 wager that would get you $7,000 will now get you $25,000 because he's plus 500,000 now.
Yeah, well, that's all part of the play.
I'm just letting people know. I'm not Doesn't mean
it's all part of the play.
I'm just sharing it.
Santiago de la Fuente, I'm telling you, he's doing. You ever watched a cat with its prey?
Yes.
Similar. It's bad around here, bad around there. Least expect it, pounce. That's all we're doing. That's all we're doing.
So you're saying boo bogeys often at the Query House? Is that what we're saying?
Bad around here, bad around there. Least expect it, pounce.
All right.
We'll get Jimmy's plays next.
Heat and cool with nearly geothermal efficiency in places you can't.
The NBA will take the Boston Celtics on the money line over the New York Knicks. We will also take in baseball the Baltimore Orioles to win the money line at Fenway over the Boston Red Sox. And one update for Jake, again, as we mentioned a little bit last break, if you want to get in on the Santiago de la Fuente train as the outright winner of the Masters, he's currently plus 500,000 on certain books. A $5 wager would net you a cool 25 grand.
You know, one of the plays of the day that I'm curious about?
What's that?
O.J. Simpson, over under. I mean, I'm just saying.
I remember, and we all know where we were, unless you're like these guys and you're 12 now, but I had the best pool party, and not because of that, or but after the Bronco chase, one of the best, ragingest pool parties of all time.
You know, the
on that day.
The Bronco chase, by the way, did you see that Ford today just recalled 42,000 Broncos?
Did they really?
Yeah. Somebody's like,
That was hot upon release. Now, I'm just kind of curious where it is.
The Bronco chase was, at the time,
the most lucrative day in the history of Domino's Pizza. True story.
Was it really?
Yeah, because it began basically at the dinner hour on the East Coast and ended on the dinner hour on the West Coast. And people were like, everyone was glued to their set,
yeah.
Right? I was an intern in New York City at the time, and it was either the day before or the day of the Bronco chase. I mean, hand on the book. I was in Times Square, and I went into a business there for an errand that I was running for MTV Networks. And I walked in, and the receptionist said, I just saw out on the marquee that O.J. Simpson confessed. Obviously, that was not a true story. You know, that
right.
was an errant report. But by the time I got back to where I was staying, and I was staying at NYU with a bunch of college kids from all over, everyone's glued to the set. And one of the guys was from L.A., one of the guys that was staying in the building, the NYU dorm that I was in. And it was fascinating because he was kind of giving narration of where the Bronco was going. But I don't know, John, that people, like you said, I mean, if you weren't around to see that, then it's impossible to state what a big deal that was.
Yeah, I remember I had a party, pool party after the Bronco chase. And upon the announcement by Judge Ito, I was at Lake Monroe out at the Four Winds Resort and Marina. In their bar. I will also ask you this. Are we allowed to still light Naked Gun and the whole Nordberg character because of that?
See, that's... I mean, kidding. I know you're kidding, but you're right. I mean, yeah.
Well,
the answer is yes. But I was trying to tell these guys, in all honesty, John, like, to the early 1990s O.J. Simpson, in terms of his placement within the American culture, of how beloved he was, you and I didn't see him play a lot of football, right? I mean,
right.
We were just on the tail end of that. But he was a self-deprecating, totally likable, gregarious, nice-looking, you know, like just cool guy.
His
right?
pitch man game was equal
totally.
To his football game.
I'm hesitant to say this every time I say it, but the only three people that I can think you can liken it to in today's day to put it in analogy would be, I mean, honestly, Peyton Manning.
Yeah.
Or Shaq or Barkley, right?
Yep.
That's it.
Oh, I mean, he and Dick Butkus was a big pitch man
correct.
Back then too. Yeah, maybe, but he was in more noted films. I think he was in Capricorn One as well. But those Hertz commercials were huge and
massive.
So,
all right, John, you the torch is yours. You're going to carry it home here. You got
I
a good show
the Eagle,
up?
Voice of the Final Four, Ted Bishop, the former PGA of America president. Man, that's a big check right there, man.
That is my jury duty check.
Good for you. How much is it worth?
Jury duty?
Yeah.
My check is for $30 because I didn't get selected. If I'd have been, you know what's terrible? There was somebody actually in my group that was like, man, I hope I get selected because we get $82.
Oh, really?
Instead of $30, yeah.
I just wanted to get selected because I had a crackhead that was defending himself.
You
in Morgan County in Martinsville. I thought, my God, this backdrop is the greatest of all time.
You going to put the 30 on De La Fuente?
Mine was a murder trial, and I didn't get selected, but it went 2 days, so I picked up $164. All right, John's up
all right,
next.
Man.
Have fun.
The IRS finally caught up with Louie.
I hadn't paid my taxes in 8 years. I owed the IRS a lot of money.
Louie was in deep trouble.
We're going to take your house.